Welcome to 155, a podcast about punk songs. Fuck Sam. Fuck Sam's month. Sam's month is over. We're going back to basics. We're going back to classics. That's right. It's another month dedicated to Avril Lavigne. Now, there's a bit of a theme that's going to emerge this month. You might even call it, instead of April Lavigne, April LaGreen. Could that be the name of the month?
Wow.
It could be something like that, maybe. If you're paying attention, you'll understand why, because this is, I think, going to end up being our most profound CanCon journalism ever this month. Don't you think? I mean, with what we've got planned.
I don't really know what our second most profound CanCon journalism is.
Probably nothing.
The thing about In Too Deep being written as a collaboration between Trouble Charger and Snow. Are we allowed to say that, though? Didn't someone get sued for saying that?
I think, now we've already dug her. Because we're talking about an ex related. It's all, as soon as we shake one CanCon branch, they all start falling.
The whole
you fall out of the CanCon tree and hit every ugly branch on the way down. What's that ugly branch saying? I thought it was some real CanCon journalism that we
fell to the ugly tree.
The real CanCon journalism that you and I know about is definitely some G-chat here shit.
That's right.
That's like some legit.
The pod has inadvertently, yes, been connected to important CanCon journalism.
Yeah. But anyways, April Lavigne, all that shit is happening. However, before we get into that, I really do think, because especially if you're here because it's the end of April and Jesse Brown talked about it on Canada Lane because we did such good CanCon journalism.
You're coming back, you're in the future,
and you're like, oh my God, they were writing about it on the 1234 newsletter or whatever it's called. Or like
1234 doesn't exist anymore, unfortunately.
or there was an article in Dose magazine that I picked up when I was waiting for
Blogtio is definitely going to write about us sure.
Well, Dose magazine's not really. I'm trying to think of some other ones. The last time I knew
Torontoist.
Narcity. Maybe Narcity could write about us. That'd be kind of cool.
Yeah. Oh, for sure.
But
we're going to be all over the pages of Narcity.
I don't know why I'm projecting that.
I had to send at episodes of the pod to reason. It was really like, hey, which episode should I listen to? Sending to someone who I feel like is eventually going to decide that they can't do the pod. Sorry, I got busy. But if not, you're right. We will.
What did you? You had
Canada
to do this
land.
Recently? Is that what you're saying?
Yeah, I said yeah to this person, the comm manager for this person.
Oh no! So that also could. That's
so. I don't know that one's going to happen.
The end of the. What did you even tell them? Oh my God!
I sent the Edward Hirsch one because.
Oh,
was
there
like,
you
I
go.
Know.
That's pretty good.
Yeah.
Yeah, I mean, look, I also
it's because we're trying to do real, we're trying to use
someone I work with was like, oh my God, I would love to check out your show. And I keep Googling it and I can't find it. And I'm like, yeah, that's probably for the best, but maybe you could start with April Lavigne because we're going to have a really funny guest. It's going to be like a whole thing. And so she's like, yeah, so maybe my coworker, this is your first listen, in which case, just try to divorce this from what I'm like in
what kind of coworker is Josiah? Do you think you're like are you microwave fish for lunch kind of guy?
No. I'm like very quiet and polite and shy until like week three, and then I become psycho and start spamming you in Slack with stuff. But the first like 3 weeks, I mean, even think of the pod, the first like 2 months of the pod, I think I was pretty like restrained.
You were so nice.
I was very like
you've just been
respectful.
Barbecuing fish or barbecuing. You've been microwaving fish basically for the last 5 years of my life.
That's true. I am. I mean, you're the one with the eggs, bro.
In the work
you're the
kitchen
one who's bringing
of
eggs.
My heart.
You're literally the boy. Wait, do you? What do you? Oh my God, you probably do. You probably do eat
bring
boiled
eggs to the office.
I used to.
I recently was in an office and I brought some eggs with me, and I specifically said there was like five people in the office, and I went, "Does anyone mind if I eat these eggs?" And they said,
"Well, they're not going to say no." Did you actually do that? Is this real?
Yeah. Yeah, I really asked an office full of people if I could eat an egg.
I'd like to know what your annual salary is and why you don't buy lunch.
actually.
I'll put it in the G-chat. G-chat, dearest Josiah and I doing salary reveals.
There's no way. I'm waiting. Now we're just going to sit in silence until the salary
Of course
drops.
I'm not going to do it. I'm too Protestant.
Yeah, but I know that it's huge because you're making you're bringing eggs from home. I know that you're fucking loaded because you're like, oh,
I save all the money that I save on not buying like a protein bowl for $20 plus tax
so
and tip
sick.
Every day.
And get a little smoothie too. Make sure that you have diarrhea, but feel good.
A smoothie as well. Yeah, like a $9 drink.
Round it up, bro. Half a hundo. Why not? Anyways, what I was trying to say.
A cool hundo for lunch. Yeah. The classic downtown office worker lunch.
You're not Champagne Sammy, but it's because you're something much more. You're like Elon Sammy. You're like Elon Musk not owning a house levels of wealth.
Yeah. Or like Steve Jobs having no furniture. You know, that kind of thing.
Except it's just you're eating boiled eggs in co-working spaces.
I just have a house full of eggs.
Oh, my God.
Work fridge full of eggs.
So what I was trying to say is I think we're going to make it big this month, finally. And in
finally,
which case,
this has been a really sterling introduction to the pod.
I feel like what we should do is just really off the top call out the Patreon, specifically because what we're doing now on Patreon. Last week we kind of hinted at it, but I don't think anyone made it that far into the bomb the music
of course,
industry
why would
episode.
They?
I don't think anyone even heard that one other than Seamus. That was all I noticed was Seamus like doing some deep BTMI lore.
We got into it on the Discord.
We hinted at it last week, but the truth is, Blink 182. This used to be a Blink 182 podcast, right? Can we all agree on that? Is that true? I think so.
Okay. Yeah.
Fine.
I'm not going to fight you.
We talked about every single Blink 182 song at length. Then we decided no more Blink 182. I haven't even listened to Blink 182 in like 2 years. And then after that, they decided to reunite with Tom DeLonge. And
they've elongated their career.
Delongated muskrat could be a thing you could say. So he's back in the band, and then they announced an album, and we're like, honestly, I mean, for me, I was like, I don't want to talk about Blink 182, but this seems like an opportunity. We got
to
strike
to make money.
This is a selling out moment. Now,
yeah,
did it work? I mean, Sam's still making eggs for lunch. I don't know if that means he's wealthier or less wealth. I actually feel like I'm being gaslit by his egg situation. But what happened was they released one song 6 months ago, and they've done nothing else. And
Are we sure it's 6 months? Should we count it up?
That's one thing we're doing to fill the time on Patreon is we're counting
we
how
do a
many
lot of live counting on the pod
just,
now.
We have dedicated to doing a weekly podcast about Blink 182. Based on one song, and it's gotten so bad or so good, depending on how, you know, someone did comment that they feel like they are being ripped off. So that could be, I disagree.
Someone commented?
Yeah, on YouTube, they said, I feel like I'm being tricked or ripped off or something. I disagree. So we did 23 episodes because they released the song Edging, and they have refused to release anything else more. Now we are on episode 24 was last week. What we've decided...
Jesus Christ, that's how many fucking episodes we've tried to do?
What we've decided is that we're going to go through the lyrics of Edging one word at a time. We put the word up on the screen and we do kind of a free association jam sesh about what that word means
to us. I don't think
it's
free association. It costs at least $5 a month.
That's true. There's a video version too, so you can see me type out the word. I mean, that's the kind of shit where... You hear that, Jesse Brown? Fucking tell your people about that, Canada Land. I don't know why I'm... I think it's just because there's kind of this Canadian political vibe, feeling this month.
Yeah, but, yeah. We're biting.
So episode 24 of this, that was the first one, and we only made... In 60 minutes, we made it through 10 words from the song Edging. So I think this one has legs. So all I'm trying to say is it's not too late. I don't think you're going to want to binge all of it later. So you should sign up for the Patreon now. Get in while
it's
the iron's
really
hot.
Like, you want it live, I think. Otherwise, it's not.
Get in while
it's
the like irony is hot, I think I should say. Could be a thing to say.
Wow, that is good.
So yeah, check out the Patreon. We're talking about Edging one word at a time. And I think it's brilliant. I think it's, and actually this week for episode 25, which we'll hopefully, we haven't recorded it yet. I'm hoping we'll get through at least 10 more words. Caleb has made us a 60-minute version of Edging to play in the background.
Oh, to just play through the whole thing. That's amazing. Because, we were just listening to slowed down kind of piano covers from YouTube. I got to say, for people who are missing, missing Globe Hell, maybe it's scratching that itch.
I'm
imagine me having to co-host Globe Hell. Like, that's a... That's something that people, I think, have been looking for.
I thought we had some pretty compelling discussions about some of the...
I enjoyed myself. Like, I genuinely enjoyed myself.
I think we talked about what... fucked. We talked about the word fucked for a long time, which I feel almost bad saying this close on the top of the hour here, assuming you're listening at prime time to this show.
Right. Yeah, we gotta wait at least another hour and a half before you can start saying fuck on the pod.
I am realizing it feels like we're trapped in this segment. So let's get out of it. Speaking of journalism, speaking of all the things that we just said, let's check out what's going on in the world of punk news. Sam, punk news, it's a funny phrase that I thought we invented.
But did we not invent it? Did you not invent this?
Turns out there was already an org doing this, an organization, I believe it must be some kind of charity of some sort, some sort of NGO. Is that
you donate? You donate to them. You get a tax.
I would hope so. Boy, wouldn't that be cool if you could get a tax receipt for DIY? Could be interesting. Anyways,
every time you go to like a show, they give you like a receipt for your taxes.
Pay what you can.
Yeah.
Now, not to sort of peek behind the curtain too much and break kayfabe too much. I think that's the right word. I'm just words that I don't know how to pronounce. I'm just going to start saying really annoying.
I feel like we haven't mispronounced a word in a while.
We've been doing too well lately.
I'm sure we have. I'm sure we've mispronounced a few words.
Oh my God. I'm trying to take my jacket off. I just did a weird stretch. You wore a jacket? It's kind of a sweater thing. I was a little cold, now I'm hot. Okay? You want to know?
Again, you've been talking for like 20 minutes straight. I imagine it's been 20 minutes heating up over there.
Oh my God. We have so much to get through. Now, punk news, not to break Kafabi too much, is it's a there's a website, punknews.org, that truthfully, that's why it's funny that we call this segment punk news. The idea is like, it's funny to say, oh, we're going to do a thing we invented called punk news and then talk about what's in vogue, how someone's pants were a little bit punk or whatever. There was a very funny one, Katie Holmes, last week. I put on our Twitter, it said she was wearing punk inspired jeans and they were just normal plain jeans. They were just jeans. There was nothing. Anyways, that's kind of the joke, but
I think, jeans are I mean, as pants go, they're the punkest pant. Or I guess bondage pants are maybe the punkest.
Yeah, I don't think that even leather pants might be more punk.
Leather pants are goth.
So the thing about punknews.org is like they're responsible for Sam's favorite kind of music, org core, sort of like dumb guys pretending to be smart,
ever may it rain,
playing the shittiest music known to me. Punk News also was like a place I remember people, when bands would announce they'd break up, people would talk about making a sandwich in the comment section. That was some sort of early internet punk. Totally. Do you remember that? Like being like, anyways, all that shit. I didn't even know punk news was still real, but turns out they've been publishing things all along. But one thing that they also do every year, which I think we're going to talk about elsewhere on this episode too, is they do, and this was pushed to the Google aggregator where I search punk every week to find my punk news. They do... increasingly abhorrent April Fool's gags. And all of these were pushed through to the Google reader. So I just wanted to quickly run you through some of the
several
punk
gags.
News. There's four of them, I think, at least.
Four whole gags.
The problem is your website has to be, to do this bit, it has to be good enough that you can tell which is shitty and which is good content. And I think... this is not a knock on them. It's a knock on basically the entire universe. But it's impossible to tell anymore. And I'll show you that in a second. So the priestess of punk propriety talks mosh pit etiquette. This is like a 1,000-word sort of agony ant style column with a picture, I guess, of an elderly gal wearing a studded collar flipping the bird. But this just looks like a stolen stock photo, I'm pretty sure. I don't think they... probably paid for the rights to this.
Photo? Don't think they took this photo themselves?
Actually, what's really confusing is when I search it, it goes to freepick.com and it says dirty old ladies. But I'm seeing a different lady. I'm seeing a different, look how
dirty are these ladies?
Well, look at the, it's the same pose, but it's a different lady.
What?
What the fuck is going on?
Did they put a new head on?
So they
put a different head on the dirty lady picture. Huh.
I'm so confused. I'm sure this is really hard to understand. This is an old lady flipping the bird, and it's also for some reason everything's hyperlinked in here, but it doesn't go anywhere. But there's some sort of, I don't know, some incredibly long thing about mosh pit etiquette. Now there's another article that says how to tell if your favorite band just isn't that into you, comma, anymore. And there's a picture of, I think, PewDiePie on here. And it seems to be like a BuzzFeed style quiz. Like, does BuzzFeed even have quizzes to be parodying any? Or no, this is like kind of a top 10 list, I guess. How to tell your favorite band isn't into you. They book a tour, but it isn't rooted to your exact city and you have to drive 25 minutes to actually see them. They haven't responded to your 857th, 858th, or 859th DM. They have changed their sound. So just all kinds of April Fool's stuff. People are not loving it in the comments, to be honest. They're being quite cruel to them. And so I don't want to lean in too much. But then there's one, this one, Celebrity Fashion Watch, which I think is kind of our bit a little bit. But this is sort of describing.
I just want to make this clear. Are you accusing Punk News of stealing our Punk News bit now? Be. Like, is that?
Maybe I okay. am. No, actually, this is different because it's not about like celebs dressing punk. It seems to be some sort of fake. Again, like this, all of this seems like it's written by someone who hasn't seen the internet since 2007. This is sort of a Perez Hilton style description of Tim from Cat Bite and Ross from Ceremony. Another fresh take was seen by all three of the screaming females. For one, drummer Jarrett famously wore a wooden necklace for over a decade. He has updated that with some new swag as if to say, the band has changed with our amazing new album. Therefore, I have changed my accoutrement. So there's just, I mean, this is, it's just so long. It's all so incredibly long. And I already lost the other one, but there was another one too. You know, there was one, I think about like another fake quiz. It was like how to tell if you're, oh no, here it is. Which classic punk rocker is your style icon? And you do this quiz and they've embedded the Jeopardy song 10-hour loop. I mean, I don't even understand. This feels like a bot or something. It feels like a, when it says doctors hate this trick and there's like the trypophobia arm with ball bearings in it. Like this feels like those kind of links or those kind of articles, but seemingly some human being has made this. And the punk rockers that you could be in this quiz are Francesca Caccina, Wolfgang Amadeus Mozart, Claude Debussy. How do you say that? Debussy?
Debussy. Yeah, yeah.
Claude the Bussy?
My Bussy? Claude with the Bussy. Yeah.
But Big Van Beethoven and, of course, Avril Lavigne, who we'll get to in a second as well, but she's mentioned here. But I guess in punk music defense, the only thing I wanted to say was this other website we love, Idiotech, which we'll
is
also
get
to.
Is that a photo of Avril Lavigne, though? I'm sorry.
It is. I was just having that question on, because she looks exactly like that gal that's like married to David Foster now. You know what I'm talking about? Is it Jessie J who is? Or there's some pop star that like just disappeared into
being married to David Foster.
Yeah. Is it her? Maybe not.
Maybe. I don't know. I don't think that really looks like Jessie J.
Oh no, it's Catherine McPhee. But Catherine McPhee is the one who's been with David Foster since 2019. But I think that the picture of Avril kind of looks like Jessie J doing like the no fucks were given that day snarl lip that
right.
Mama
yeah.
Facebook groups. Anyways, all of this is to say, to be fair to Punk News, I also thought that this article on Idiotech, which we're going to talk about in a second, was also an April Fool's joke, but this one's not. So that's what I'm trying to say is it's actually too confusing because this is a sincere article from March 29th. Called Four Pop Punk Throwbacks Every Pop Punk Lover Needs to Remember. And the four pop punk throwbacks embedded are All Time Low's Remembering Sunday, Blink-182's All the Small Things, Green Day's Wake Me Up When September Ends, and Fall Out Boy's Sugar, We're Going Down. So the bar is so low that I don't think you can really be... It's just too confusing. So anyways, I apologize for breaking Kafabi, but...
Wow. Do you remember these four popular pop punk jams? What kind of memories do they bring back for Lou? You're never too old to blast these in the car on your drive to work or even in your bedroom. These timeless classics are worth remembering.
Maybe like if you're like a 90s, maybe, oh my God, maybe when we get older, think of this. When we get older and we're all like in whatever the future version of a home is. The people are, maybe even us, like the stroke victims who are trying to remember, like, or people with dementia, they're going to be playing us All Time Low in the home to help us remember.
I like, think so. Like, help us, remember. Like,
oh. Low-key Warp Tour vibes. We're like waltzing to some fucking, oh my God. I hope I don't live that long. What were you going to say?
Yeah. No, I'm just. Frankly, I'm just depressed. This is really good, though. Even if you weren't a fan back in the 1990s, nearly everyone recognizes Blink-182's All the Small Things. It's true. No, that's really great. Oh, they have so many popular pop punk throwbacks. These have to be. Are these just like generated by AI? Is that what's doing this? Where it's like just write a list.
Well, that's the same author that's always writing these Idiotech articles. This is the only author for Idiotech. But I just wonder if, like, because
I think a lot of blogs are doing that now, and I got to imagine that's part of why it's so like disturbingly generic. But I don't. We shouldn't think too much.
It's still, I guess. Is it better or worse than the terrible April Fool's one? That's hard to tell, actually. But let's talk about your piss instead. Your little piss.
Well, thank you so much for letting me talk about my piss. Now, I feel like any punk worth their piss has already seen this article. But for those of you who don't read 93.3 WMMR Rocks' blog, which is, I believe broke this story. So over here on Wormer.com.
This is from Philly. Philly's rock station, 93.3.
And writer Erica Banaz has got the scoop on the filthiest punks from the filthiest part of the world. That's right. Aussie punk band releases first urine-filled vinyl LP. Oh, boy. What was it? There was that one God. Band did the menstrual blood record. What do you remember? You know, everyone loved them for like 6 months.
Boy Genius.
You know who I'm talking about.
Was it Boy
Genius? No, people are currently in the middle of the 6 months of Boy Genius. It was Boy. Anyway, so look, we've seen some bodily fluids in some albums.
What's interesting
before.
Is Erica Banas.
Erica, yeah, it's like Eric Bana.
Isn't that an actor already? She seems to be
Eric
from
Bana, yeah.
From the D, actually. She's from Detroit, so she must be selling stories all over. She's incredible. Rock/classic rock/wrestling writer.
Oh, yeah.
Wholesome badass. Long story short, I'm basically a Renaissance woman. Let's fucking go, Erica. You get the.
Oh, yeah,
you get
Peggy Olson moving her stuff down the hallway.
She
and
has like
men.
A sick rocker top hat on. She's so badass.
It was a perfect. Claude Debussy put out the LP pressed with menstrual blood. So this Aussie punk band has released one filled with.
Oh, wait, are you trying to say it was perfect pussy? Are you scared to say the word pussy on the pod?
No, I was kind of just trying to do a callback. I'll say it. Perfect. It was actually much worse to whisper. So look, this is not from the band Perfect Pussy. This is in fact from a band whose name I haven't found out yet.
It's impossible to find. She didn't put it anywhere on here. Oh, private.
No,
function.
It is. It's literally. Okay, so a punk band in Australia is about to set the world on fire with an incredibly unique number one gold record. Now, we don't mean an album that has topped the charts.
Oh, my God.
And has
that's
been certified
so clever.
Gold.
That's so clever. Number one, get it? Was that part on purpose, you think? Number one.
It must be. I didn't get that. But I feel like, okay, because I was kind of distracted because I feel like it shouldn't be set the world on fire unless, like, they have an STD or whatever. It should be like,
right.
Punk band in Australia is about to extinguish the sting of a jellyfish sting with an incredibly unique number
make it,
one
No, they're
world
about
record.
To make it rain, I think, would be probably the...
There we go. That's right. Private Function. Okay, I get it. Is releasing their new album... and it looks like some leech.
It's probably
speak,
Australian
maybe.
For something. It's probably some sort of Australian racist code. Actually, it's hello asshole written backwards. I just got it.
Ah, there we go. Okay. This Friday,
maybe it's written
March,
straight words in Australia.
That's true.
Maybe this record is made of poo in Australia. Maybe it's a CD made of poo in Australia, where everything's
interesting.
Opposite.
Yeah. So they're releasing multiple versions of the LP, including various colored vinyl variations. However, fans quick to the early pre-sale of the album were able to snag a super rare gold version of the album. Why is it gold? Because the vinyl itself will be filled with the band's actual urine. Yes, really. For proof, the band shared the video below showing each member entering a bathroom and coming out with containers filled with their urine. Side note, some of these members should really consider drinking more water because the color of their pee is far too dark. Erica, that's good. A good shout out to hydration.
That's good.
Let's
listen to just a second of their song Yellow. I think that's probably the best one. If I could find the, here we go. Yeah, let's just see what I don't want to play that video because it's going to be really loud on here. But this is their song Yellow. So it's just some. Kind of sounds like that Wodonga song that we used to love. Oh, this is actually a cover of Yellow.
I like this.
By Coldplay.
Oh.
Yeah, this is like some shit you'd put
in
the newsletter.
Yeah. I would
literally pause right here and then write my paragraph.
Be like,
and be done with
yo,
it.
Yo, Sam's getting the zoomies again. Fucking big time piece of shit.
So anyways, that's, I think, punk news, isn't it?
That's all the news that's fit to pump.
All right, well, let's get into the episode because, first off, there is so many things that we just touched on other than Australian piss, which is probably just Foster's, let's be honest. Other than all of that, there's so many – thank you for that courtesy laugh. There's so many – pussy. There's so many – oh, my God. I have to tell you something in the chat.
You gotta tell me something. Whispering pussy has made you need to G-chat me something. I'm very.
I gotta
interested.
Close the tab. This is such a failure
oh,
on my part.
Oh no!
When that
you gotta
happens.
Shut it down, man. That's you gotta terrible. Shut it down.
Something else happened, folks, on Twitter. That I mean, that's. I would say it out loud if you were behind the paywall, but because you're all cheapskates or possibly
that's
coworkers
this
or
is...
Jesse Brown, I don't think it's gonna work. You know. Other than the Australian piss, there's so many things that we just touched on that are newsworthy to me. And the first thing I want to point out is that we've never really talked about Radiohead much on this show. This song, Here's to Never Growing Up, features the line, singing Radiohead at the top of our lungs, off the top.
It doesn't just feature it. It's the
framing device of the entire song, which I think is mostly what we're going to be talking about right now. But speaking of these terrible, unfunny April Fool's jokes, the Eve 6 guy actually changed his account to be like the Radiohead account and got permanently banned on April Fool's just to be like, oh, we're Radiohead, oi, bruv, or something. And that now his account's gone. That's just one thing I wanted to point out that's kind of funny off the top.
So it turns out that the Elon's Twitter does have its...
it does have its benefits, I guess.
Despite, it has benefits. The world's complicated.
Despite the
world's
horrible Doge thing. But yeah, so that's what...
I don't know, man. Here's the thing. All April Fool's jokes are bad. Having an April Fool's joke that like shows up days later and seemingly breaks aspects of your website is an actually good April Fool's joke.
That's true. Especially when you're banning the Eve 6 guy. That's pretty tight.
Yeah, like honestly, here's the thing, man. Like the enemy of my enemy is, you know...
Exactly.
I don't know.
But then the other thing I was thinking is, like, so this song opens with singing Radiohead at the top of my lungs. I meant to actually do a little bit of research about this, but I feel like, you know, we're among friends here. We can do research in real time. The other thing that's going viral this week is everyone has their opinions about Boy Genius, which is how I've decided to pronounce Boy Genius. I've never heard a lick of the tunes, really. But I know that before it came out, it was going viral that Lucy Dacus has this lyric about Leonard Cohen lyrics, who then was also featured on Succession this week. I mean, there's all these, hopefully we're going to really plug into the zeitgeist right now. But there was this lyric from Lucy Dacus about listening to, did you see this? Have you heard about this?
No, no, I haven't. You heard about this? No. Oh, whoa, what is it?
It's like,
I can be a good sidekick.
Everyone was roasting these lyrics from verse two of the song, I guess called Leonard Cohen, really, really on the nose here. But Lucy Dacus says, Leonard Cohen once said, there's a crack in everything. That's how the light gets in. And I am not an old man having an existential crisis at a Buddhist monastery writing horny poetry. But I agree. And everyone was saying that's a bad lyric. I don't know if it's a bad lyric. I don't think I mind actually.
That's a good lyric.
I feel like if there's ever been a case of like, I see you roasting this post what you've done, that's better. Like, this is an example, because I think it's kind of funny, actually. I think people
This is legitimately funny. Yeah.
But then it got me thinking about, like, placements of other sort of incongruous artists. I mean, sure, it probably makes sense that I've never heard a lick of the tunes, so I don't know. But maybe this kind of folk music, they would like Leonard Cohen. I don't know. But it still, it feels a little bit awkward, which is what people were resonating with. Now, Avril Lavigne singing that she's singing Radiohead at the top of her lungs was always very weird. And I was curious if you have any thoughts. I remember there was a Snow Patrol song that mentioned Sufjan, like, when I was like 20. And it always stuck in my head because I'm like, Snow Patrol's not allowed to know about Sufjan. That's for people not on the radio. But I don't know. Like, do you like it when artists shout out other artists in like a pop context? Or I feel like it's always weird.
Yeah, I like it because it's sort of like, oh, we exist in a shared universe. You know, we spent a lot of the Sam's month talking about how this sort of desperate desire to create like shared universes for popular culture is stupid. And yet, I mean, this one jumps out because I remember when the song came out being like Radiohead, like even then being like, That's the thing. No,
it's so funny. Well, I guess the other one I just wanted to mention before we move on, I should have mentioned this earlier so you could think of, I'm sure there's more, but I remember Counting Crows on the song Monkey. They say, got nowhere but home to go, got Ben Folds on my radio. That one I was like so stoked by. So maybe that's a different example, because Folds, Counting Crows, the is only like the ones same I can universe. Think of are like,
yeah, I mean, I can think of like, sort of canceled bands, like on the first Brand New record, he sings about the Smiths and Morrissey. But to be honest, like I sort of feel like this song exists. Like I think the way that this song sounds, the structure of it is like the sort of part of a moment that is basically we are still living in terms of like instant nostalgia. And the fastest way of doing that is instead of actually saying something like insightful or poignant, you can just be like, hey, we all used to listen to Avril Lavigne. You'd be like, oh my God, I feel a thing about singing Avril Lavigne at the top of my lungs with my friends. So it's just sort of like a really, really hacky shortcut that I do think we've seen more of. But I remember,
I guess also
being into that Brand New album before. Now I would never, because I'm good. I'm a good guy.
I think I've seen a lot of people say they still listen. So I don't know. I mean, it's not like you're watching. Not me Woody though, because
I'm cool. I'm a good guy. I'm a good guy, and I don't do it. But that was at least like I think before I felt like everyone that I knew, and like it became like cool to like the Smiths, then it became cool to not like the Smiths or whatever. Mm-hmm. But it was like a way of like really telegraphing like, oh, this is like, I'm listening to this shit, even though we're a pop punk band or whatever. And you're like, my God, Morrissey? That's crazy.
That's like so olden days to me. I feel like every hardcore
guy. The Ataris used to sing
like,
about it too.
Yeah. Morrissey's, I feel like, I think what you're getting to is that this is a singular thing, because Avril Lavigne singing, pretending to be pop punk, singing on top of a new country song that she wrote with her husband, Chad Kroeger, and shouting out like, singing Radiohead at the top of my lung. Like, it's just so, I think the only other maybe precursor for this was like, I just checked, It was a few years earlier, Party in the USA. She sings about a Jay-Z song coming on, and then all the headlines at the time were like, she was like, oh, co-written by Jessie J, actually, who looks like Avril Lavigne. So there you go. But she, all the headlines were like, I remember she was like, I've never heard rap music in my life.
And then she based her whole personality around it for a year and a half.
She also pretended to not, she pretended to not be smoking weed in that video. Remembering just all these Perez Hilton posts are coming back to me now, but I think this is maybe.
Wasn't it Salvia? It was the summer of Salvia.
It was the summer of Salvia. Absolutely.
Did you ever smoke Salvia? I still didn't smoke weed when Salvia was a thing.
No, I've never, I didn't. What do you mean when it was a thing? Was it actually?
Because there was like a period of, yeah, there was like a period of time where it wasn't illegal.
I think I learned I learned what it was from Miley Cyrus, honestly.
From Miley Cyrus, yeah. It was just like, you'd just be high for like 30 seconds or whatever, but in those 30 seconds, you'd like definitely think that you were going to die. Like I've never heard anyone describe it as anything other than like existential misery.
I mean, that's pretty cool. But anyways.
But that video was obviously a big moment.
Yeah, but anyways, my point is this thing about singing Radiohead at the top of your lungs. So this is the opening lyric of the song "Here's to Never Growing Up" by Avril Lavigne. Now, other than that line, this song is mostly like a generic. It is seemingly built to be like sung at a Red Cup party. At the time that it came out, I don't think I cared about it very much. I didn't mind it. Like I've always had a soft spot for Av for sure, but this never like. Transcended like What the Hell or some of the other ones, but you know, I didn't hate it. Now I think it's like, if I heard this in the grocery store, I would definitely be fucking stoked. Like, it's
what even listening to it like before we did the pod, it is like a really, really great new country song. Like I have a soft spot for this type of music, and it, you know, I have to be like at a cottage and I gotta have had, you know, a couple of CLs already in me, but then all I want to do is like, there's an Apple Music playlist called the Sandbar, and it's just these songs, and they're.
It's one that you made, or it's a.
No. That's the Apple Music like playlist. It's all songs that are like, dude, God, drink beer with my friends, listening to Avril Lavigne in the sun at a cottage, yeah, and it's like, they feel so good, like, and they're. You know, they've honed in on an actual, the mathematical version of what makes a song feel this good. Like the sort of Nashville template. It's like these chords, these lyrics, this
tempo. The pre-chorus is really good too. Like those chords in there give it sophistication that really hammers home. They earn that idiot chorus with the sophistication of the pre-chorus, I think.
Yeah, totally. Like, listening to it, I'd kind of forgotten the verses or anything else, because the chorus is just so big. Because it is, like, it's really good. It's a really, like, perfectly anthemic, like, it in the wake of like, Kesha and then people trying to sound like Kesha. Like, it sort of fits into that moment in pop music so perfectly. And it like fully strips anything Avril out of it. Like, there's really, outside of like her, I feel like there's a distinct voice.
There's a hint of Complicated, I think, in the verses. I think a little bit of Complicated in there.
Interesting. So. I feel like it's mostly her delivery. Like, and she does have like a really, it's interesting, you know, this being the second time that we've done April Lavigne. We did songs last year. Well, this one's April Lagreen,
but yeah, that's true.
Sorry. My bad. April Lagreen. Like she ultimately has like this like really, really compelling and totally like instantly identifiable delivery. But it's the fucking Radiohead thing, man. Like, I'm never going to, that's the only thing that exists in the song.
It's so hilarious. And so, I mean,
was it the only three syllable Radiohead? What is that? Four singing. Radiohead.
Well, okay, so I went on a deep dive about this because I couldn't stop thinking
singing
about
Warren,
it.
Singing Warren Zevon? No.
Singing Zevon. Singing, it could be like singing Simple Plan, or like it should have been like Blink 182 at the top. If she had said singing Blink 182 at the top of our lungs, this would have been like the hugest hit ever. But
I just googled like popular bands 90s singing Alice in Chains. Singing Chili Peppers doesn't work. Okay, singing Weezer. Okay, there's okay. Blink 182. No,
I think Blink
182. Roses. Nine Inch Nails at the top. Offspring.
There's
singing
many.
Stone Temple Pilots.
There's so many good clips of Sam you get.
What singing was, Counting Crows.
What if it was Perfect Pussy?
Goo Goo Dolls. Flaming Lips.
What if it was Perfect Pussy?
Say perfect pussy, perfect pussy at the top of my lungs.
Sam, do you
There's
like...
There's so many options.
Do you like Radiohead?
I love... I mean, OK Computer is the record that... Like, the actual, like, outside of Dude Ranch, that was, like, the first alternative music that I ever liked. That, like, seeing the Paranoid Android music video on Much Music felt like...
It's
like that was life changing shit to me. What about you?
Well, and then what? Did you keep up? Do you still like all the bleeps and bloops and whatnot?
No, I like what was it, after OK Computer. Does it immediately go to Kid A?
Yeah.
Is that what's next?
Uh huh.
Yeah, and by the time it got to Kid A, I was already like too into pop punk that I was like I like Kid A. Like if I put National Anthem goes on like mixes all the time because I just think it's like a groovy fun time. And like motion picture soundtrack, oh, heartbreaking! So the demo good. Of that song,
so good.
God, but man. Again, it's like the demo is much better than the dumb fucking whoa, 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 whoa. It's all
so
over the record.
Stupid. You're so wrong.
You like that? You like
the? Of course, I love pretentious bullshit, and I love
no
I,
the
I,
demo.
I haven't listened to all the new stuff. Like I feel like Radiohead has turned into a bunch of guys that look like different eras of Phil Collins. It's like definitely like. British man with halitosis music at this point, but still I love bleeps and bloops. I mean, I think I like Kid A more than OK Computer, but I kind of have a softness for all
stupid.
Of it. I like all of it, to be honest. I think that
I put on OK Computer in the last like couple of weeks, just like front to back, you know, just chilling around the house. And like it, I mean, that's
dude, it's
that,
crazy.
That is
Let Down is so good. There's a sick line version of it. Anyways.
When they use Let Down in, and again, a great, great soundtrack music, right? Like Let Down in the Bear, unbelievable. Also, they use the Vitamin String Quartet version of motion picture soundtrack in the first season of Westworld, right? Did you watch that show?
Yeah, I did. But that
in like the moment where
you're kind of ruining like, Radiohead
for
me.
First
as you talk,
season. No, but when she's like wakes up and like realizes it's all. Oh my god!
But yeah, no, I think Radiohead is sick, but I do think that they're like truly, they're not like prog. They're not indie. They're not even all. Like I think they are literally the only possibly. Art rock band still around like their level. It's not like underground music. It's art rock that is mainstream. And I think that's really sick. And it makes it even more hilarious that Avril Lavigne in this country sing along Red Cup song. So I was trying to figure out what song it might be. So I started poking around the Radiohead Reddit, which is a great place to be. It turns out, this was posted four years ago. This user has since deleted their account. What Radiohead song was Avril Lavigne talking about on Here's to Never Growing Up? Not that I like Avril Lavigne, but I am wondering what song do you think she was referring to? I'm thinking maybe it was Everything in Its Right Place. Now, I want to pause right there because I have been having an intrusive thought for the last 2 years, and I haven't had a place to put it. So I wanted to put it here of what if the
Everything
song...
Everything in. Yeah.
What if the song was Everything, Everywhere All at Once? Like just really quick, he tried to fit all the syllables in.
Jesus Christ.
It's not good, but I can't tweet
I'm
it.
Glad
I
you exercised
I just
that.
Need to put it somewhere.
Is that a sincere thing? Could you imagine, like, again, I'm just picturing, like, you're being jammed in, like, you know, the kitchen,
yeah, like
someone's apartment, and someone's
stuff.
Like, yeah, like, Welcome to Paradise has just played. You've just finished singing along to Buddy Holly, and then someone's like, let's turn this shit up.
It's right, play. Or like, Idiotech.
I'm sorry. See, but Idiotech, you could fucking party to Idiotech.
Yeah, but you'd be singing the beat. Like,
yeah, it's true. But just imagine like a room full of people. You got your arm in arm with your brothers in the picture.
Oh, okay, wait. They've just reminded me of something.
What a tune.
This actually is also in a Katy Perry song. Katy Perry in We Make Out in Your Mustang to Radiohead. This was in one of her, I actually can't remember what song this was, but the one that got away. So maybe, wait, when did that come out? I should really research this before I hit record. That actually was the year before. So there was like or 2 years before. So there was a time in the early 2010s where pop stars were singing about how much they love making out to Radiohead. Now, I think that still tracks more. Like you're like, you know, you have like an artsy boyfriend who you're making out to Radiohead. That makes more sense, I think. But singing along out loud, now they're saying I can't imagine now. I think by now you might already know what it's going to be. But I just wanted to show you a couple more. So this is another post about it. And someone said Radiohead has finally made it big. Avril Lavigne mentions the band in the chorus of her new single. And then they wrote huzzah, which I think is just a fun thing to see written out. But, you know, people are talking about it more. Someone said, hey, that's precious. Idiotech Anthem commented, this has to be a prank by her songwriters. It just has to. Now, again, I want to remind you all that this song was co-written with Chad Kroeger, who was her husband at the time. We're going to hear from them in a second. But all of this...
But also, she's a writer on it. Like, I do love the idea of being like...
Yeah, totally.
I'll be honest with you. I feel like part of what made me nope out of like Radiohead was... People who like Radiohead are—they're like NoFX fucking fans,
or like they are.
But they only like Radiohead. They're like the biggest losers in the world.
They're like
liking Radiohead sucks. Yeah, it's much worse than liking Blink 182, which is pretty fucking bad.
I feel like liking Radiohead was like lining up at HMV for some sort of like 3D DVD release of an album that's in 3D audio, but like never even, you don't even know what a local record store is. Not that I mean,
oh yeah. You have one tattoo and it's the little guy.
Yeah, it's the little guy. Pretty cute little guy though. But anyways,
it's a great little guy.
Yeah. There is some, definitely. Thank you for calling out the low key misogyny on the Radiohead subreddit. Discussing.
Yeah. Let's just come on. You know,
it's almost like they're saying name five songs if you're gonna wear the t-shirt. Well, here's a picture of Avril Lavigne with Chad Kroeger handheld, and she's wearing a Radiohead shirt somewhere. So, you know, maybe she's just low-key promoting the single, who knows, but she does own the shirt at least. And someone does say OP missed a huge look at this photograph of Avril Lavigne wearing a Radiohead shirt opportunity. Well, that I'm going to downvote that, actually. I just downvoted it. But, you know, probably at home you're listening to this, and this is the first time in now 45 minutes that you've been frustrated with the show, because it's so obvious what we're getting at, which is that speaking to Billboard, speaking to Jason Lipschutz, who, goddamn, he does the opposite with all the things he says on here. Or typing, I guess. first, a clarification. When Avril Lavigne kicks off her new single, Here's to Never Growing Up, with the line, singing Radiohead at the top of our lungs, she is not talking about the gloaming. Oh, Jason Lipschutz, you sassy little queen. Creep, she explains when asked about the line. The explanation makes sense. So, yeah, I mean, it does make sense. I mean, that's the song Avril Lavigne would be blessed singing at the top of her lungs, right? I'm a creep. I'm a...
Yeah.
What does he say?
I guess
a widow?
Could.
Does he say I'm, is the lyrics, I'm a creep, I'm a widow, I'm a widow creep?
Yeah. I think it's, he's talking about Little Space, which we learned about last week.
On this, you have to listen to an hour, about 10 words, to learn about what that is. So anyways, that's just what I wanted to tell you, is that it's about creep. Did you think it was the whole time and you were humoring me, or did you?
No, I honestly never. It truly, like, up until this moment, never occurred to me that.
Isn't that weird?
That it would be creep.
I don't know why.
I guess it does make sense. It's creep.
Well,
yeah,
speaking of creep,
that was like a big hit.
Speaking of creep, here's Avril Lavigne talking to Matt
Lauer.
So
disappointing. This is like, you never want to know how, like, a magic trick is. Like, I
know.
You kind of ruined the song for me.
I'm sorry. I'm sorry for ruining it. But I think I'll save it with the cover section that's going to take us into the wee hours of the morning. Now, speaking of creep, speaking of ruining things, my perfect segue. Speaking of creep, here's Avril Lavigne talking to Matt Lauer about it.
Here's to Never Growing Up.
That was good.
Avril, welcome back. It's nice to see you.
Thank you. Good to see you.
I should have a tattoo of that, Here's to Never Growing Up. I like that message. Isn't that good? What are you trying to say in this song?
I don't really want to grow up. Yeah. No one really does. Let's stay young forever. It's a state of mind.
Is it possible after 10 or 11 years in the business to still make music just for the joy of making music, or does the business creep in here?
Sure, that's why I'm here. I'm here because I love music, and this is going to be my fifth record, and I'm really excited because I get to work with L.A. Reid again. He discovered me when I was 15,
he's cool.
And he's actually here today.
Yeah,
with
we
us.
Like L.A. He's
Support.
Over here, which
I
is
love
great.
You, L.A.
And you co-wrote this song with someone special?
Yes, with my fiancé, Chad.
Congratulations.
Yeah, guys.
Isn't
Thank
that
you.
Great? All right, you're going to sing it now for us?
Yes.
Ladies and gentlemen, Avril Lavigne.
Was this hat like part of the era?
It seems like it was.
Aggressive top hat.
I'm just curious. You watched the music video, right?
I did, yeah.
I couldn't figure out who the drummer was in this era, but for some reason he has a pirate patch on his eye in the video. Mm. And I didn't understand.
I thought it was just a vibe choice.
You thought it was a vibe eye patch? Could you do that nowadays?
Yeah, I didn't think
nowadays?
It was a practical patch.
Because here he is here with, I think he's patchless, but I just want to see. He's also really old. Like, maybe he was like, I'm so old looking, I need to patch it up.
Yeah, maybe he's trying to cover up his crow's feet.
Exactly, his smile lines.
You and I are going to have to start thinking about wearing our eye patches.
Wearing Nelly band-aids on my...
Yeah.
Yeah, that's him. He's... I mean, the song kind of sucks, but it's also sick. It's interesting with age, you know, as so many things are.
I mean, we talked over it, but I really only... The chorus is the only thing that retains.
Well, here she is on the red carpet of the MMVAs with Fiancé. And I love her, like, spiked Statue of Liberty crown that she's wearing.
Welcome to Fan Expect from your performance tonight.
What's up, Views? I'm really excited to be here tonight. I'm performing my first single, Here's to Never Growing Up, and this is the award show that I watched growing up in Canada. And so it's good to be here tonight. It's exciting as always.
Great. That first single's been doing so well for you, and the video too. What's up next?
Yeah, it's exciting because I'm in the top 10 on iTunes right now, and it's awesome. The support from the fans
top
has been incredible.
10 on iTunes.
So thank you. And
wow, those are
then,
big moment.
My record will be coming out in September.
Great. And Chad, you're just here supporting your gorgeous wife.
I'm just here.
Oh, I guess they got married in between.
Yeah.
Oh, yeah. Well, there you go. They did it. So nice.
I have to be her support
system. Actually a co-writer on the song.
That's also very true. You know, it's she supports me. You know, when I go out and I'm on tour and stuff, she comes out and stays with me. And when she goes on tour, I'm going to do the same thing. And that's how we're going to make this work. We're just going to be together as much as we possibly
it's
can.
It's so much fun. Like, when I went on...
You kind of had a bit of a vocal fry back then. Did you notice that? Because they're really doing...
When I go out and I'm on tour and stuff, she comes out and stays with me. And when she goes on tour, I'm going to do the same thing.
He kind of was like, maybe he's trying to lean into like a pop punk feel. Because the other thing that's happening right now that I've noticed is that the world has realized that it's cringe to make fun of Nickelback. And they are kind of having on like a image rehabilitation tour with the release of their album that like sucks in a new, different way for Nickelback, I think. And that's confusing as well. But they seem to be there. They keep posting videos. They've gone on like every Barstool vertical. They're on some podcast called Bussin', which I was like, I don't want to see Nickelback on a thing called Bussin'. But I keep seeing, they keep retweeting these little clips of Chad, like, I don't know. There's just, he was saying something about how, like, teens are playing Nickelback at parties now, and that's how he knows that they're cool finally or something. Like, it's just these new levels of bizarre cringe.
I feel like the good news is, like, you know, you were sort of early on the, like, Nickelback is actually good train. But now that, like, it's annoying again, I think Nickelback might be bad again.
I think they might be. Yeah, it's possible.
Yeah,
but
like, I feel like we've come back around and we can just safely say, like, it's kind of annoying.
But he was, one of his ways of sort of rewriting history was he was arguing that, like, Rockstar and Photograph and all of these songs were written to be, like, new country songs in a way, or, like, to reference that music. And maybe that's what's happening here.
Yeah.
Maybe he's the reason that it has that, like, hint of new country on here. I'm not really sure. But anyways, I feel like we could watch more live videos, but it's like, they're all exactly the same. I think
I'm sure they're just playing to a track and it's just that vibe.
Yeah.
Right?
Mostly I needed to know if that guy had a pirate patch or not. The other thing about the music videos, they recreate a scene from the complicated video, but like, unless you're really keeping track at home, and there's something called an ice watch that is product placemented.
Yeah. There's a lot of ice watch in there, right?
I've never seen an ice watch before. Have you? I mean, you probably
only like 100 times watching this music video.
Just real quick, I wanted to just see if there's any other lyrics that jump out at us, because I think the Radiohead one takes up so much space, but like singing Radiohead at the top of our lungs with the boombox blaring as we're falling in love, got a bottle of whatever, but it's getting us drunk. I do like that line. Singing Here's to Never Growing Up. I think she like yells like raise a glass or something at the end, or like there's some sort of like there's
sort of like a,
oh yeah, she says, yeah, oh, raise your glass and say cheers, cheers. Oh, so it goes from here's to never growing up to cheers. So the actually there's a cheers in this song. No wonder you like it.
No wonder I really feel an emotional attachment to it.
And she says, we'll be running down the street yelling, kiss my ass. I'm like, yeah, whatever. We're still living like that. Do you think that Avril Lavigne has some sort of like interior life that we don't know about that she doesn't let us know about? Or do you think that she is just kind of constantly like hoisting a red cup, a Dixie cup?
And no, going, I think this is like just kind of, I think this is sort of the vibe. Yeah.
That's interesting. I mean, that is kind of the Canadian will come out.
I think she's
out,
living her
so
life authentically.
Yeah. She's letting the Canadian out.
You gotta be careful.
We'll learn about later. But yeah, I don't know. Very interesting song. I do like generally songs about not growing up. Obviously it's relatable to me. I mean, I don't really think I am ever going to feel like I've grown up. I think I'm just going to be really old and cringe and I'm going to start saying bussin'. But what about, do you feel like you're never going to grow up or do you feel like you're growing up?
I mean, mostly just because I get tired. But, I was thinking about this listening to the song. What was the moment when we flipped over from songs like, wouldn't it be now? You know, when did things change? Because for our parents' generation, all the songs are like, one day we'll be able to finger each other at home, you know? And then like, there's this inflection point where every song is about fingering, but it's about, like, nostalgia for fingering. And, like, when is that change? Because, like, obviously there's, like, you know, Forever Young or whatever. Like, I mean, I know those songs have existed for a long time, but it feels like it wasn't, like, the default mode of popular music. But it does feel like we went from this, like, chaste era of, like,
Trying to see,
you could only fuck if you were married or whatever, and so you had to sing about like, I just can't wait to go, oh, I'm gonna marry you so fucking bad on Saturday night. Whereas like this feels like it's of this moment of again this like instant nostalgia. And you were saying like it feels, yeah, it's built for like a red solo cup party, but it's built for like a red solo cup party in your late 20s for people who've already had like three kids. Like that's the, like watching the video, I was like, that's who this is for.
There's not very many songs about fingering, actually, to be honest. I'm just checking it out here. I mean, there's a lot of Lil Wayne lyrics about fingering. There's a song called The Fingering Song by some sort of joker type of guy. I guess Fingering Nuns by Crossing Worlds. Probably some kind of edgy. It's not as popular as, I don't know what music your parents were playing for you when you were growing up, but I certainly didn't.
A lot of novelty songs. A lot of novelty songs and a lot of Wayne.
Yeah, I don't know. I don't know when we switched, but I have a lot of videos to show you. So I guess, would you like to continue fingering each other intellectually over top of some videos?
Yeah, man. Sorry.
Are you okay? Are you okay right now?
I'm fine.
What happened?
Yeah.
Are you a little?
Listen.
Did you have a little?
I was worried that I was going to have to switch pee-pee break? From my all. Well, I eat free range eggs because, like, I think it makes me a good person. And for the last, I don't know, pee break that lasted maybe 5 to 10 minutes felt like an eternity to me because I had a moment where I thought that I was going to have to stop buying free range eggs. I was going to have to start buying poor people eggs. But thankfully,
the funny thing is,
my eggs will be free.
I mean, you have to give them a little bit, and your financial. This is an episode about your financials, basically. So Sam just got some financial news that was devastating momentarily, and then it turned out to be okay.
In the middle of that episode, I want to say this is in the moment where, just because I have GChat open for you, and I saw, and I just like to, I'm an inbox zero guy, and so, like, as the video was scrolling, I clicked over from GChat to my email to clear the email. So I had an email from our accountant. And while we were watching Chad Kroeger and Avril Lavigne be interviewed on the red carpet for the Much Music Video Awards, I had a heart-stomping financial moment that I suspect you can hear in the episode. My demeanor, like, I think my throat probably constricts. Yeah. I stopped paying attention. I was not engaged.
I thought.
But I'm back. I'm chill now.
Because your accountant made a typo that was...
My accountant made a typo and doubled a number.
In a bad way, not a good way.
Yeah. Normally I'm all about exponential growth, but not when it comes to amounts that I need
really
to give
need
to
you people. To post salary in the tier. But we'll,
kind of amazed that you and I have never done it.
I mean, like, you know that I'll tell you all of my salaries ever, and you'll feel so guilty for would. Anything you've ever done. You'll feel so...
Well, that's the problem is I feel like we're probably at... I imagine there's parity between us, but there probably was a period of time where...
I don't think so. I think that you...
when you were trying to make it as a podcast...
I feel like the accumulation... yeah, I feel like you are definitely sitting on a nest egg that I will never dream of. But you know what? We'll figure it out.
Calling me a bird?
Well, speaking of birds, let's check out what's going on with this bird, Avril Lavigne. Is that offensive to say?
Yeah, I don't think you're allowed to call women birds. This year, bird. We should bring that back, though. It's sort of like
well, she
old
likes Radiohead. Oh, well, it's British. British people call them birds, and if she's going to say that she likes Radiohead, then she must be a bird.
Ooh, squawk, squawk. It's Avril's time.
Now, where are we? What's Ooh, happening?
Oh, buddy. I don't know. Have we got to show you some videos. Avril Lavigne covers, I
okay,
think.
Okay, first of all, no, we're nowhere near the covers, my friend.
We've got a long fan in this room.
We've got a long night ahead, so you better bask in your second financial dream. In fact, whatever you were going to...
I feel like I got It's a Wonderful Life on like my bank account.
Whatever you thought that you owed them, you now owe that amount to me, I think, is what we've realized.
You know what? Yeah, I think that's fair. I need to tithe it.
That's right. We're a long ways from covers, my friend, because I wanted to tell you.
You know what I am trying to figure out if I know one of the people who's in the background of this Avril Lavigne.
That's how we're going to make this sort of looks like work. We're just going
to
be.
I was
going
to ask if you were if you were there.
So much fun. Like,
you know, I've only been to the MMVAs once, and I had tickets to see Nails, and instead I went to the MMVAs.
Oh, that sounds like the right choice, probably.
It feels like it was.
Feels like kind of probably only a better, once. Probably more of a stay at home night it would have been. But, you know.
Right, best. That's the only way to win. Yeah.
I think this is how we know that we're old is that this video that we're looking at is from 2013 and it looks like a normal today times video to me. Doesn't
nothing,
that to you?
Nothing.
No, there's nothing
yeah,
dated
nothing
in
about this.
This
looks wrong to me. Yeah.
Anyways, let's move on. The lyric video for this seems to have some kind of early UGC, which has meant that YouTube is flooded with content because I think maybe there was like some sort of Avril Lavigne challenge and then they just took a bunch of screenshots of all the poor saps that submitted and did some kind of 3D edit. Like you can barely tell, but it seems like the lyric video is UGC. So there's a lot of that on there, but I don't really want to talk about that. I want to talk about this song seems to have hit at the time when like fandom and anime music video was at an all-time high. So I want to show you a few fandom videos of this. This is by Gustavo Silva. This is Bat Family. Here's to Never Growing Up. It seems to be all just different like Batman family portraits. And we're going to hear from a Batman-adjacent character later, so I just thought we should start with Bat Family. I don't even know
I don't really know anything about the Bat Family. Like, some of this looks like, I guess...
I don't really know any either.
I know a bit about Robin's family from Batman
I think
and Robin.
Robin is the same as Nightwish? Nightman?
What's Night?
One of these guys is named Knight
Fighter
something.
Of the Day Man?
Yeah, I realized I was doing It's Always Sunny for... Well, look, there's a heart here. One of those guys looks like... Whoa, that Batman has a sig.
Is Batman allowed to have a sig?
There's so many different art styles that I can tell it's different artists interpreting the meaning of Bat Family. But I don't know... Yeah, I'm not really sure, but...
So just to be clear, this is just for you and I, because it's just the song, right?
Well, yeah. I mean, I'll post the notes and I'm building a story here. I mean, just stop doing your fucking taxes right now. Good Lord. Dude.
I'm not doing my taxes anymore. I've stopped doing my
Good
taxes.
Good God. I'm trying to teach you about the Bat Family.
Sorry. I'm open.
So I don't know why the Bat Family is in here, but there's just so many things that have been attached to this song for these fandoms. So much so that I thought I could summarize it with a few of these multi-fandom videos. This is a 2K collab uploaded by Yellow Heart. This is multiple different IPs at once to kind of a sped up version of the song. I feel like this is like every TV show ever in here. Oh, Nerve, I think. Was that Nerve?
Oh yeah, that definitely was Nerve.
And there's lyrics in here and even dialogue.
Okay, once again, though, in terms of, like, what era this is,
It's very confusing.
Some of it looks like Riverdale, but I can't tell if it's just like actors that I know from Riverdale.
No, I think there was Riverdale. And was in there. Yeah, I think there's a lot of CW shows. There's Nerve again.
There's definitely Nerve, yeah. Nerve is like, it's basically like
a... that's Riverdale. Nerve. Do they list the fandoms in this multi-fandom?
It's a great thing.
Sped Up is pretty good.
They mention all of the... there's like 21 different collaborators on this multi-fandom edit.
Aww.
But it doesn't... they don't even say what their fandom is, so... kind of interesting. But the lyrics aren't there. So that I thought was kind of an interesting thing. But then I noticed there's a multi... a period drama multi-fandom. So this is just all different period
drama. Period drama? What is this? A Perfect Pussy LP?
For those who don't know, Perfect Pussy was a band probably from around the time this song came out. It was a buzz band for a blip in time. And the drummer, I thought, looked like Richard Dreyfuss.
Is this like an Amadeus fan cam? What is this?
Marie Antoinette is there. I don't know. I actually really hate period movies. Do you like them? Like period meaning like olden times. Like they always win the Oscar for best wardrobe. Yeah.
I can't watch any of that kind of film. About menstruation because I'm like Dave Foley in Kids in the Hall. But I would rather fucking die than watch a period.
Yeah, and
it's,
even
it is definitely my least.
Whenever they're like,
movie.
Oh, it's like Jane Eyre, but with clever contemporary dialogue. No, it isn't. It never is. They never. Nothing will ever save the fact that it's like really annoying and boring and feels like school and it sucks and it's fucking terrible.
I'm trying to remember which movie it was, but I think we've talked about this. I only have ever really wanted to walk out of two movies where I've said to Ashley, like, we should go. And she's like, well, we're here. One was Guy Madden's My Winnipeg. And the other one was the only period film I've ever seen in a theater, which is The Last Mistress, which I remember being sort of billed as like, it's like a period piece, but it's like really fucking sexual. I hated it so much.
Really?
I was like, we have to go. And she was like, we're here.
Actually, there was one
watching The Last Mistress.
There was one that I made myself like, and I really don't like it, but it's because it was Whit Stillman, who I was like trying to fuck with for a little while to be pretentious, you know? It was like, oh, I like Metropolitan, and I don't really like any of his other movies. Actually, Damsels in Distress is kind of good, but there was one called Love and Friendship that I tried to make myself. I think I might have seen it at like a film festival at TIFF or something, and I was like, I was too green. I was like, oh, I should probably like this instead of film festival, but it's fucking, get out of here with that shit, fucking
no,
nerds.
No, it's the worst kind of movie.
Nerd-ass cosplay bullshit. Movie. But anyways, that's why we should move on to this final fandom video in the fandom section. Now, I really like this one because... it's Here's to Never Going Off a Barrel Racing video. Kayla Barnett says, none of the clips are mine. Also, I do not own the song. Just a barrel racing video I made from boredom. So thank you, Kayla, for making this barrel racing video.
Your boredom is our gain.
Yeah. I mean, I don't know much about barrel racing, but it seems kind of tight. It's just a horse running around.
Oh, wow. They're just horse running around a barrel.
I love this watermark that's on, like, the best YouTube videos, too. Except this one I can't even read. Created with a non-activated version, I guess it says. But I can't read the bottom. Xylon?
Yeah, it looks like...
I don't know, I think this song works really well with barrel
racing. Does this make you miss Calgary?
This works really well with stolen barrel racing footage versus a period piece or Bat Family. So I don't know, that's kind of just some fandoms that I wanted to briefly touch on.
I love fandom. And now which fandom do you identify as a part of? If you were going to make a fandom camera or whatever,
Here's
Never Going Up. What fandom?
A fandom edit. So that would mean like that's not just a casual fan, right? Like you're up on all the lore. You're ready to make an edit with like the most crucial scenes.
Yeah. You're gonna put yourself out there saying like this is it. The definitive vision.
So it has to be like
whatever.
Visual as well.
I guess it. I mean, has anyone made like a fan edit?
I would do like an Albert Brooks.
Like a Pedro the Lion.
I'll do like a fan edit of Albert Brooks movies with like.
That would be sick.
With.
There's like Pizza the Hut, Radiohead.
No, that's Mel Brooks. That's Mel Brooks. keep up.
Oh, sorry.
I'm a step deeper. But with like that song, pray to a God that I don't believe in, over top of Defending Your Life, I think that's what I would do. What about you? What would you do a fan?
I would do Mel Brooks. It would be all Young Frankenstein.
There probably is that.
All the racist jokes from Blazing Saddles.
Have you tried watching his new show? I was like, I was definitely going to watch it, but then I heard it's horrible. And it's a period piece, and I know that I can't. That's the other thing. They try to make like period pieces like screwball comedies. Like, you're not going to say it's a period piece. We can't do this. It's going to suck. Don't do it.
Yeah. No, it's a mistake.
I mean,
the last time I saw Blazing Saddles, I was like, comedy doesn't age great, you know?
Oh, yeah. I mean, that's that movie is more of a straw man in movie form now, I think.
Right. Yeah. Yeah. It's not a real film.
So speaking of whatever, I don't know. There's all kinds of segue exactly. Who gives a fuck? I mean, if you're listening still, you're going to keep listening probably because I don't know. Why are you listening? I guess is my question. Why are any of you here? But we could move along now to some parodies of the song. There's quite a few parodies of the song. Here's to Never Growing Up. And first, this one's called Here's to Never Breaking Up. Now, the account that uploaded this is called Official Comedy. Which I thought was kind of interesting.
Oh, wow.
They copied the video, it looks like. And he has a pirate patch, even. Interesting vocals. Giving you something in the G-chat here.
Oh, yeah. I mean,
it kind of sounds like
the verse really is complicated, eh?
I also just think if you're gonna do this much effort with the visual, you could probably do a couple extra takes on the vocals.
It's true. There's a real like cognitive dissonance happening here between like so many sets, so many costumes,
actors.
And definitely first take on the.
Also, okay, it's worth pointing out, you know, we're not going to explain Darius again, but this is Darius levels of delivery on the chorus. Like, you'd think,
absolutely.
Here's to Never Breaking Up, you'd think, okay, that kind of fits. So they must have found things to, you know, screaming at you, screaming at your head at the top of my lungs or something. No, it's just a whole bunch of syllables that barely fit and don't rhyme in the chorus. Here we go.
Yeah, let's.
So if I put what? Splenda on my Special K, I don't know what that means, like weight conscious.
Well, I think you know I put Splenda on my. It's just like
you know my secret.
Your partner knows your.
Oh,
your
I see
tricks.
Various quirks. If I see another dick, I don't know if I can get to third base, and then it cuts to, I think you have to see the visuals that. She said,
holy shit, is that a roach?
I thought she said it's not a roach, which was confusing.
No, is that a roach?
Okay.
You kill all the bugs.
But then she says, here's to never breaking up. Okay, I see.
What? Like, so much effort has gone into this.
We live like work stars? Every single person in this...
We gotta rewind it.
Every single person in the official comedy troupe looks like a different bad fake stock model from a Reductress article.
We live like work stars. Leave early from bars.
We live like work stars?
Because I think the lyric is we live like rock stars, and so that's like the satirical
twist. So they've subverted
twist.
The word, okay.
Rock.
The night is ours. Willy chips and clip our toenails. They say just break up, but they don't know us. We don't ever and we never ever will.
Stay
I mean, I guess I just don't understand. Like, usually parodies are like someone is a complete nerd and has nothing else going for them and their Minecraft community loves it, or it's a school project. But these people are like in their 30s. Like, I just don't understand who,
well, they're who was forcing comedy. Them to
do this. Official comedy does have 300,000 big subscribers. Comedy. I guess it's big comedy forcing them to do this. Oh, there's Donald Trump jokes on here. There's all kinds of stuff. So, yeah, I guess, I mean, my God, that was bleak for me.
People are really having to defend it. It seems like there have been some negative comments. People are like, I don't understand why the comments are so negative. This is funny.
Yeah. Probably some official comedy putting the hit out on there. But, okay, let's move on. Yeah, this one is absolutely just called Here's to Never Growing Up Parody. It's by Neil Hasmold. I might want to get that checked out, Neil. Just kidding. It's not spelled like that. But here we go. I don't know what this one is because...
Saying happy birthday at the top of my lungs.
See, this at least looks like how it sounds.
So he's kind of subverting the actual title of the song.
Yeah, and this is, by the way, this is there's a little watermark on it. Says this was created using how-to.
Oh, yeah.
Looks like that. Yeah.
That was fun when there was all those, like, little... text to animation things. I used to do like show announcements with those annoying videos.
Yeah.
So this one's just about like the concept of time, which I kind of like. Don't you get forever, A? It was a really damn long time.
Sing happy birthday at the top of my mind. Nice. Is it your birthday calendar? I'm trying to think who's got the next birthday in my calendar. Who am I going to send this to? Oh, you know, oh, this episode comes out. Technically, the episode's kind of coming on Thursday now?
Yeah, I guess sort of.
Okay, so this episode is coming out on Friend of the Pod, Justin Taylor's birthday.
Oh, my
God. His wife, Nicole, was a guest on our Weaker Bands episode. So Justin
Taylor.
This one's
for you, Justin.
Whenever you listen to this, I feel like when I see you now, you tell me you're backlogged on the pond.
That's whatever.
You know, which is perfectly reasonable. But whenever, if you ever hear this, just know I was thinking of you and on your birthday.
He says, I live like I'm God, but I can't do sod. People think I'm odd. I think he's probably not referring to sodomy, but instead the kind of British, I don't give a sod, which is still sodomy, but through a few layers of sort of becoming a saying or something.
Is that real?
Sorry to sidetrack Justin's birthday announcement by talking about sodomy.
No, it's fine. But I was thinking, but like this, like the old sod is like a
I think
a sort of
yeah, I'm sure
popular in Tobacco Bar. Is that basically just it's the old sodomy, giving him the old sodomy,
or the old sodomist? I would imagine. I mean, go find out. Maybe you could engage in some sodomy there. Speaking of sod, this next one is about COD. I'm talking about Call of Duty, the game Ghosts from the Call of Duty franchise. This is Call of Duty Ghosts. Here's to Call of Duty Ghosts. This is uploaded, as you can see, by this wonderful watermark. This is COD Comedy Bryson. So shout out to COD.
COD Comedy definitely sounds like a St. John's comedy troupe, right?
Hoping that there's no migrating hosts.
You play this game?
I mean, I don't remember if I played Ghosts or not. I probably did. I play every Call of Duty game for like 10 minutes, and then I just play online. I don't play the campaign. That's like me.
Wow.
Multiplayer is all the same, but it's fun.
What's the Call of Duty game with the guy who's always in the memes is from, you know?
Oh, Ghost?
Is that who that is?
His name is Ghost, so he must have started in this one. I can't remember.
That's what, yeah.
Yeah, he's pretty cool. He's in, I think, the newest one. So I guess I'm hoping
like,
that there's
I
no...
I like when I see a picture of him on the internet.
I'm hoping that there's no migrating ghost. It's definitely an even more niche reference than singing along to Radiohead. So shout out to COD Comedy Bryson for that one. Now, this is the final parody. This is a League of Legends. So keeping in the gamer realm. I think, is this a mobile game? I can't remember.
Playing anything we want, trying builds on a going 80.
See, once again, at least this looks like it should.
Even though our chances are
now, I wasn't going to say anything, but I thought, I feel like this is the same person singing on this channel. this sound like the Call of Duty voice?
Yeah.
Also, this League of Legends one, they say, here's to never giving up. That's too general for your League of Legends. I don't know much about the lore, but I think you need to maybe... Runin's Ezreal top. That's probably something.
That seems like a video game word.
I think... I think the same gal might be lending her voice to multiple video game themed Here's to Never Growing Up. I mean, you got to find your niche, so maybe that's paying off, or it was back then, some 10 years ago. Now, this is another. Now you've heard of gender parody. Well, this is gender parody. I'm calling it. I just decided.
Oh no! Oh no!
No, this was just uploaded as a male version, but I think they've just kind of down pitched. And I think, you know, we don't endorse this title for it, but this is called the male version. It's uploaded by Carrie Butera. Here we go.
Singing Radiohead at the top of our lungs, with the boombox blaring as we're falling in love. Gotta follow whatever.
I guess it kind of sounds like Mariana's Trench or something.
Yeah, definitely. All our friends go hard this. See, I can finally listen to this version.
Right. Finally, for the fellas.
We'll yeah. Finally, music for men.
I mean, it's very unnerving, actually. Avril's voice does not sound good in that tone. It's bizarre.
Well, that's because just men shouldn't be singing. It's a woman's task. Yeah.
That's true. That is true, Sam. And thank you for saying that.
Since you brought us down the gender road.
Let's clip it. Yeah, clip that and print it.
Yeah.
Now, finally,
the last 10 minutes are a real high water mark for us, for sure.
Well, speaking of things for guys only, how about this guitar lesson video? I'm joking, everyone. Calm down. And also, it was Sam that said that. But this is how to play it on a guitar. I just really like this one because it kind of looks like it's shot on VHS or something. It's by Eric Blackmon Music. And also, he's like playing vibey chords.
Yeah, just now this just sounds like Counting Crows to me.
Yeah. I don't think the original has this open acoustic sound, does it? What was that jazzy ass chord?
Up in the canyon.
He starts explaining. Well, as a chorus, that's E. I love his voice.
Okay, now I'm strumming like this.
It's like you're watching Bob Ross.
So I'm going. Strumming pattern.
Look at that swipe. Down. Edit on the video.
Down. Up. Up. Down. Down.
Yeah, this feels like it's like a true time capsule. Do 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 do.
But how is it? Okay. So like this. This seems like it's from 1995. Not.
Yeah, this doesn't feel like it's from 9 years ago.
So.
But that's cool.
Yeah, I love it.
Maybe it's deliberately, like, you know, it's like people using, you know.
Yeah, it's proto-vibey. Yeah. Well, we're going to get to more
of
that.
Mini DV tapes.
I think it's time, Sam. It's time to dig into the pile of covers. So let's get under the covers together. Well, that's what we should say always. But actually, before we do, you know, last year for April Lavigne, our dear friend Georgia provided us with a series of Avril facts. And this year she's back. Mm. So we're going to cut to Georgia. And learn some Avril facts, and then we're going to cut over back here, and we're going to have a very long night together. And hopefully Sam's financials will stay in order.
Hello, and welcome to a new segment called Avril Lavigne, where we're going to be going over some of the loves of Avril Lavigne's life. This week, it is Chad Kroeger who wrote and produced this week's song and her 2013 self-titled fifth studio album. So, Avril has claimed that she met Chad when she was 17 in the Roxy nightclub in Vancouver, and she was drunk and he didn't know who she was. And then in 2003, Nickelback presented Avril with the Juno Award for Best Album. They did like promotional and award show stuff together, as artists tend to do and bump into each other. In these events in the following years. Avril was with Derek Whibley till 2010. 2010 to 2012, she is with Brody Jenner. And then she goes into the studio in February 2012 with Chad Kroeger. July 1st, which is Canada Day, they decide to start dating. They're pretty patriotic to decide to start dating on July 1st. August 8th, Avril is scrapbooking in the studio and Chad has written on a piece of paper, on one of the pages, "Will you marry me?" She sees it, she says yes. A couple of weeks later, they sort of tell all to Hello Canada. And then July 1st, 2013, so Canada Day again, they get married in France. They separate in September 2015. They get divorced in November 2016. Yeah, that's the timeline of their relationship. When they were married, Avril released a cover of How You Remind Me, which apparently when they were in the studio recording the album in 2012, as a joke, she was like, oh, we should cover this, because she needed a song for a soundtrack. And then that came out. I don't really know what else there is to say about Avril and Chad. There's a 10-year age difference, which, he's 6'1", she's 5'1", so there's a whole foot in height difference as well. That's Avril and Chad Kroeger. It's been alleged that he cheated on her, and that it was tumultuous relationship, but I don't know, that's all speculation. What I do know is they have performed together since of recent, and that's Avril and Chad.
Sam, how's your financial portfolio doing since I peed a few seconds ago?
Better than ever. I got all the eggs free range and otherwise that I need. I'm feeling pretty good. I'm ready to spend some emotional money.
Well, you know what?
I'm ready to cash in.
Because we've spent so long listening to your horse shit music that no one cares about. We haven't had to.
Outrageous.
We haven't had a chance to hear Nightcore. And there's.
Oh my God.
It's been so long.
But you liked my music. But you even.
I liked your mom. I did like your mom. But I mean, I've been missing this. I've been missing a nice, sweet, scary pile of YouTube videos. What do you think, Nightcore? How does it work?
I mean, it's good. I feel like the song either needs to be like as slow as it is, or then like faster. Like this is just sort of
it's
a little mid to me.
It's a little mid. It's a little mid core. I would almost want to hear it like slowed down, like chop not slop.
Yeah, totally.
Yeah, it's a little weird, but I think it's gonna sort of fit into the first section. So for whatever reason, this song, I need to check. I think it might be around the time that he first rose to prominence. My friend, I fucking wish, Maddie B. Raps. This song seems to have plugged into that world of like YouTubers with like child music prodigy YouTubers covering songs, because there's a shit ton of them doing this. Like this is like a YouTube cover anthem. So I'm so excited to play for
great.
You. Actually, I'm gonna play that one later because there's a payoff here. So we're going to start with someone named Tiffany. Actually, if you still have famous birthdays open from the segment earlier that we've since deleted from the show, look this name up.
No, but I can pop up.
Look up Tiffany, Tiffany Alvord, because I'm actually confused about Tiffany Alvord. And I think this is
Alvord?
A-L-V-O-R-D. I'd like an age. I'd like to know if Tiffany Alvord's age in the year of Arvord 9 years
you
ago.
I just want to say I now I'm not weirded out by this because of the number, but just you generally asking me to look up a YouTuber's age on famousbirthdays.com, I was like, we're gonna have to delete this section too, man. A weird fucking
how
thing
how old
to be
was Tiffany Alvord at this time 9 years ago?
At which time?
Nine years ago.
Now you're asking me to do fucking math, dude. Here, I'll tell you the birthday. And then you can do the math. You can't even copy and paste. Here, okay. Figure out. Okay, so is it that plus 9 to today? Is that what you're trying to figure out?
Doesn't it just say their current age? What? Oh my God.
Yeah, this it does. So oh, I get it. Okay, because so Tiffany was 21 at that time. Sorry, 21. I hadn't read the whole page yet.
Okay, yeah. 21 at the time, Tiffany Alvord. So that means Tiffany is 30 now, right?
Yes. Correct. That's what Famous Birthday says.
Okay, so Tiffany Alvord. I mean, I just think if you're 21, this is a very bizarre, unless this was re-uploaded or something. But no, the song's 90. Like she's in a child's bedroom.
Oh yeah, this is unsettling
for a 21-year-old.
Yeah, like with like a huge teddy bear.
I mean, keep in mind I have about 30 teddy bears beside me right now. But she's wearing a Buzz Lightyear T-shirt, and yeah, it almost looks like the room is made larger so that she seems like a little baby. There's Cookie Monster on the wall.
There's Cookie Monster. Wait, but is that the point? Or is this sort of like a parody where she's saying, like, here's to never growing up when you're 21 is about wanting to be
being like a Disney adult? I don't know.
Like,
I
maybe she's been changing the lyrics. We've talked over it because we're so disconcerted.
Well, I don't think she said fuck, but I mean, even if that's true,
drinking.
I think the interpretation of the lyrics should be like, I want to be a teen forever, not like, I want to be a widow 9-year-old.
But that's the whole, this is really unsettling.
That's weird.
Running down the street yelling, don't look back.
So that's Tiffany Alvord. Up next, we're going to hear. Wait, I need to fix something.
It's fine, I'll just hang out and watch this really creepy video. We live like
rock stars. We live like. Okay, sorry, I got it now. Okay, so up next is someone named Dave Days, which I think I've heard of before. I mean, this one. This video
always
is
always Dave Days. When's it gonna be Josiah?
Dude, this video
Days,
is
know?
Fucking creepy though. Tiffany Alvord, like that's.
No, this is really unsettling.
So
dude.
Dave Days is doing.
Oh, cool.
He kind of seems to be doing a little bit of a pop punk, a little bit more pop punk with it.
I just love that we really are in Josiah Boy's territory, I think. Like, he's like a little too old to be a Josiah Boy.
He's a YouTuber. He's 31. He's from Pennsylvania.
A lot of 31-year-olds.
But this is definitely more pop punk than I thought.
It's great.
It's like when you hear a sick pop punk song on like Degrassi or something. Or like I imagine Rock has songs like this.
And they all definitely look like they're actors on a show like Degrassi. Like they're not really convincing as a band.
Yeah. Especially the drummer.
The drummer's really struggling. Now he's wearing that tie and t-shirt.
Now the reason I waited is because this one, I think what's confusing is this is the most Maddie B seeming person. This is Megan Nicole. Maybe is she on Famous Birthdays? Megan Nicole.
Nicole.
And more because I'm just curious who she is, not necessarily to know her. She's 29.
Yeah,
she's
on Famous Birthdays. She's even more popular than she is the 5,196th most popular person on Famous Birthdays. Did they get you? Are you on Famous Birthdays?
No,
yet?
I'm not. Of course, it's only you. Because we're talking about your brethren and sistren here, these YouTubers.
That's
so
true.
It's kind of.
I am the 146, 599th most popular person on FamousBirthdays.com.
That's pretty. Wait, was it 155,000? Is that what you said?
No, 146,000.
Oh, you got to get a lot less famous, which I think will happen naturally as we keep doing this.
But we got to make sure we catch the moment. So everybody stay sharp.
I was going to play Megan Nicole first, but then I noticed that this Megan Nicole video is featuring Tiffany Alvord and Dave Days. So I'm so confused by that. They must be like squatted up.
Yeah, they were in like some sort of Avril Lavigne hype house.
Yeah.
Content hype house.
But she reminds me of Maddie B, the way she's kind of smizing and walking towards the camera.
And here we're on like
a playground. Yeah, the Here's to Never Growing Up vibes again are like, I want to be 11.
Do you love hula hooping? Do you? There's a lot of hula hooping in this video.
So much hula hooping. And I think they like throw up. Oh, look at that. Oh, there she. I just saw Tiffany. And Dave. There they Aww. Are. The whole gang is here. The beat is banging on this one. Well, she's got all the hula hoops
They're
at once.
Amazing at hula hooping.
Is it really that hard? I don't know.
Also, oh my god, when was the last time you tried to hoop a hula?
Dave, I mean, it's been a while. It's been a minute. Dave Gaze is kind of low-key dressed like a Proud Boy in this. Do they sing or are they just hanging out for views? It's just a cross-promotional thing. Oh, look, the whole... Oh my god. Oh my god. See the third what? Name on here?
Hold on. No, the next up is covering it.
You see who that is?
Oh my god!
It's the next person. It's John D of Simply Spoons. This is who I had next on the list. He was also in the video.
We've watched Simply Spoons before, right?
I don't know, but like, I've found a honeypot of YouTubers with swoop hair singing this song. Call up all our friends. Wait, do you think the label like hired these people to cover it, to juice the numbers?
Maybe.
Could that have been a thing? Meet you at the spot. So this is John D and Katie Z of Simply Spoons.
We've watched some. The name was familiar.
I just can't believe it's the next guy on the list. Like, this is just an Ouroboros.
You've been targeted.
I found a human centipede of YouTuber.
Wow.
I bet you the label hired them to do this. That's my guess. You probably worked on this, didn't you?
Yeah. This is. I'm like, how could it possibly be? What? Kiss my. Also, none of them want to say ass.
Well, they're probably not allowed because their handler would hurt them, lock them in the basement of the hype house. Well, I think we're gonna leave this particular crew, but there's still a couple more. Very YouTube-y people. This person's name is Jake Coco.
So good.
So let's check out Jake. Singing radio head at the top of our lungs.
With the boombox blaring as we're falling in love. Real dry drum sound.
Real dry. He's playing every instrument. Oh my god. He's also dressed like a Degrassi. Everyone's dressed like a Degrassi The Next Generation person. A lot of smizing going on still. But this guy seems too old, no?
Yeah.
Jake Coco? Is Jake Coco famous? I don't know. Like, this, it's hard to. I actually need to check each video because I can't tell which one is.
Jake Coco is his name?
He has 330,000, so he's got to be on there. Jake Coco.
Let's see. Jake Coco, he's about 40,000 more popular than me. Jake Coco is 38, and yeah, he's the 1,449 most popular person on Facebook.
I think he still said, he said kiss my ass. He's willing to.
Damn.
Somebody said, I love the fact that you haven't changed the lyrics like most people do. You just accept them and sing them. You have my respect. This is brilliant. Your voice is like the most natural sounding compared to other YouTube singers. I like it.
Well, and that's why he is the number two most popular person with the last name Coco on FamousBirthdays.com.
Who's the most famous?
Let's check it out. Milana Coco.
Of
I was
How
hoping it was going to be like Coco from the film Coco.
Well, this is kind of a little bit more of a down-to-earth YouTuber. This is Anna Free. You can check if she's on there, A-N-A, and then the word free. But this one's a little bit more down-to-earth. It's kind of like an audition tape for a reality show or something. Anna Free covers. It's definitely more...
Anna Free, still more popular than me. She is the 113,367th most popular person on FamousBirthdays.com. And she is 35 years old.
Yeah, you can tell. She's a little bit classier with it. Not as desperate as some of the younger tubers.
Now, she is the 12th most popular cancer named Anna on FamousBirthdays.com. It's like my favorite. They really break it down.
If you stay forever. This one has more VH1 vibes to me, I think. This is how I would explain
it. It doesn't feel YouTube-y. I
don't
like it. Now, in case you're wondering, Desiree, I think you are.
Yeah,
I am the 33rd most popular Pisces named Sam.
Now, tell me if this person's on here, because I don't. I think we're. I think that might have been our last official tuber. Yeah, no, I don't think he's on here because he only has 3,000 subscribers. So don't even bother looking up. That was kind of the YouTubers, I think. But let's move on to
great making section. Sure
this guy. Oh, actually, maybe this guy does. He has look up NIIC. Actually, see if Nick is on there because Nick did somehow get his cover added to the official Genius page. It. Well, he did scam his way into the Genius page. So this cover was the only one mentioned on the Genius page for the lyrics of the song. I think it's because Nick with two eyes and a C. He's fucking belting it out. With those
Jesus sick. Graphics are so good.
I just can imagine like the producer being like, are you sure you don't want to tune it down? Like, are you sure you can belt it? And Nick is like, oh, trust me.
Singing radio. I got this. Oh, Nick is cool.
No, Nick is fucking dope. Now up next is Abby.
Just right up there.
Oh, it's kind of getting grungy with it in here.
Yeah. Nick, you think you know Nick, but you don't know Nick.
I love it. Up next is Abby. Now this is Houston Ever Growing Up, Avril Lavigne, One Direction, Kesha, Weedus mashup cover, which I thought was an interesting title, especially because it's just all of Houston Ever Growing Up in its entirety, and then plays little bits of those things towards the end. But
singing Radiohead at the top of our lungs with the boombox blaring as we're falling in love.
I love how British Abby is.
Singing here's to never
yeah.
He's like, bloody hell, mate.
Oh, call up all
my mates.
Go hard this weekend for no damn reason. I don't think we'll ever
great, like, real casual eye movement, you know? I'm looking down, I'm looking up. Sort of all over the shop, but I like it.
Is it multicam or cuts, you think?
I think I'm gonna go with cuts.
I love his hands in the pockets of his like tufted leather jacket. I love this bloody bloke. Well, as we kind of move around, let's go global then. We're in Britain right now. Let's head over to Germany. Specifically, the show The Voice of Germany, a blind audition from 2013. This is someone on The Voice Germany, Joy Masala. I just love those grease. Like, do you see those judges? They're like two greasers. Yeah. They look like wrestlers who are like Fonzie themed tag team. Who's those German greasers on The Voice?
I feel like.
Was it? Did he just say Was ist das? Was ist das? They should have their own what? Master race?
They should be able to sing our songs. These are America's songs.
Well, it's Canadian. It's literally Canadian. First.
I mean, you know, North America, cultural America.
You think they're gonna turn the chair?
No. If they do, they're turning for the song, not for this. Not for this. Whatever the voice is in Germany, like Gemisch.
Scheiße.
The voice is quite preposterous. I don't think I've ever really watched a whole performance on The Voice.
I know, it's so funny. What a stupid concept. It did give us some great Nate Roos gifts, though.
Oh, that's true. Oh,
wait, that guy's chair didn't even turn. They can't even show the chair moving because it doesn't work.
Hold on, are the Greaser twins actual twins? Their shit turns around together?
Oh, there we go. Yeah. It's a tag team duo. The Greaser twins. Oh.
Wow.
Du willst die Entscheidung und mehr Videos sehen? Dann klick hier.
Dann klick. Duncan Carr. Man, it's so good that they didn't win the war. I can't imagine if we had to talk
for
like
that reason, you mean? Or is that, that's why? Interesting that you would say that. I had another weird German one, but it's not here. But this one, I'm just like, you know how there's like TuneCore things that are uploaded to YouTube, and it's just like someone's shitty CD baby thing, and you're like, what is this? Like, look at this lady called J.SCO, and her album's called You're Going to Miss Me When I'm Gone, but it looks like it was like cropped out of like She Was a Bridesmaid or something. Like, it's like, it's just like, yeah. Such
people have been deleted from this photo,
or it's like her stalker made this album art of her or something. Like, it's so weird.
I'll make you famous.
You're gonna miss me when I'm gone. On
famousbirthdays.com.
You're gonna miss me when I'm gone. So this is from Jay Sko, album You're Going to Miss Me When I'm Gone. This is Here's to Never Growing Up. There's no apostrophe in the word here's.
Singing Radiohead at the top of our lungs with the boombox blaring as we're falling in love. Got a bottle of whatever and it's getting us drunk. Singing Here's to Never Growing Up.
Oh, yeah.
There we go.
Call up all our friends.
There it is.
This weekend for
reason. She has a whole album of Sia covers.
Meet you at the spot.
Oh, wow.
Half past 10.
Sia's not canceled. I feel like we've talked about this.
Don't ever
when are we allowed to watch that movie as well? I don't know.
Change, yeah, when will it be free?
Forever, stay. If you stay.
Interesting arrangement.
Singing Radiohead, the top of our lungs.
Ooh, yeah.
I'll miss her when she's gone.
I'd be smashing that turning button right now. Like, I'm reacting like
I think we could be the Greaser twins for The Voice Canada.
Yeah, okay. I gotta look that up.
So that's J-Sco. Now, so now we're going to get into, we're gonna deconstruct it again some more, but first we're going to do a full band, some full bands rocking it, if that's okay with you. This is called a full band / rock remix by Julian Bowen. Now, I don't really understand this one. It says, additional guitars and drums performed, composed, and recorded by Julian Bowen. But like, and people are like, oh, this is way better than the original. I can't really tell the difference. I guess it's like...
No, this has like kind of the Travis Barker remix drums, you know?
They just like change it slightly? It's too subtle.
Yeah, it's not good. So I'm really struggling to figure out who those twins were.
Oh, you're trying to find the German Greaser twins?
It's really bothering me, this stuff. They've had so many. When you just look up Greaser Twins, doesn't give you much. Oh, wait, I think this is them. They're a
band kind of a bit more rock.
Boss Hoss.
Ooh, Das is good, Boss Hoss.
They're famous for covering Hot in Here and Hey Ya by Outkast.
Well, that one's just kind of, I don't know. It's kind of whatever. But this one is supposedly a pop punk version, and I love this bizarre.
Singing Radio.
Channel 3 looking art, like you're like trying to turn on your NES, and it, but then it appears with this graphic. This is the band An Honest Year.
Yes.
But I don't see how it's a pop punk version.
Well, I think this is how pop punk kind of sounded to some people for a while.
Again, like, what possible year could this even be from? These graphics. These are like. This is like the channel that just shows text news. There's some sort of weird synth in here.
And we're never gonna change. Say, won't you say forever stay?
Well, this band is on the Emo Is Back tour.
Wow, that's good to know. That it's back. The members of Boss Hoss have names like Boss Burns, Hoss Power, Hank Williamson, Gus Brooks, Rusty Rocket.
And so for those who might have lost track, you're talking about two Greasers from the German Voice video.
Yeah.
Two videos,
Ernesto Escobar
ago.
De Tijuana. Ooh. Hank Noodle. There's a lot of people in the Boss Hoss.
Well, here's another pop punk version of the song. This is Cyrus Killen music. Like, does this one sound pop punk to you?
Yeah.
It sounds like a straight up like cover of the original. Here, this one's a little bit more punk, I think. Singing Radiohead at the top of our lungs. With the
boombox blaring as we're falling in love. Gotta follow what I'm I mean, this just sounds like a old Steady song.
Oh, here we go.
Oh, yeah.
This sounds so weird. It's gonna get even more difficult, but this is quite difficult. I'm just being honest.
No, I think this is good. This seems like a song that could be like in Sam's month too. I'm stockpiling.
Well, I don't know. Let's hear how the pop punk goes. I think it's just like too MIDI for me also. But maybe you'd like this. This is by Vadim Erlin. And this is a rock metal cover by his band Monatum. And you can see him doing some real metal faces in this artwork.
Oh, yeah. Yes. I feel like he tried to go with a metal font, but it's like a Christmas font.
Yeah. Also, what kind of metal is this? Is this DeGente?
I mean, it's just good. Oh, man. Dun 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 dun.
I don't know if it's working really, but
no, it's good.
Well, you get okay, decide, and we'll compare it to Matt Gerst's metal remix, which is coming up now.
Ooh, yeah.
This one, I hate this. What does this sound like? Is this what Trivium sounds like or something?
Yeah. Trivium Witches. But...
okay, here's Matt Gerst's metal version. What is this? Is this metal?
I mean, look at it. If it says it's metal, it is, I believe.
This seems like one of the main... This reminds me of what I think He Is Legend sounds like. Does it?
I mean... there are like always two really good songs on a He Is Legend album, and then there's like eight that sound like this. So yeah, you're
right. You know it. Okay.
Yeah, absolutely.
Yeah, I don't know about that one. Well, let's check out. Let's get into individual instruments. This is a drum cover by David Aliaga. Really cool graphics at the start with some smoke and stuff. And what I like about this one is. He loves to do his little syncopations, but it feels like he's always falling behind, but in a way that's like very vibey.
He's struggling.
Just about to, he's like way out of the pocket.
He also looks, he looks so much like actor Rich Summer.
Yeah. Poor right? Rich Summer, always getting dumped in every movie. You see that guy, you're like, this guy's about to get dumped.
Well,
listen to that.
He's really having a moment here.
He keeps coming back. He somehow comes back, but he's like sloths as hell. Or is he perfect?
Technically, like, seems like he's got, like, really good, like, you know, all wrists. Like, it, you know.
Yeah.
But he has no internal clock.
But it, like, makes him swag. He's almost, like, Questlove with it or something. He, like, has, like, some swag to it. I love it.
So he's I hope he's recovered. This feels like what he's making. Like he started the YouTube channel in the wake of his most recent breakup in a comedy I'm watching.
Yeah, actually, he totally has Freaks and Geeks Nick vibes.
Yeah, totally.
All right, well, let's check out just this piano version of it. From the album Piano Dreamer's Best Friends. Stock photo of two best friends walking down the street.
It looks like you and me.
That's us. We should wear Daisy Dukes the next time we're together. I mean, this was just purely nice. We're getting our way through the pile. I'm gonna keep moving though. This is called a viola mashup of Growing Up. Here's to Never Growing Up and Complicated from Tikka Adderley. Doing some percussion on one of the violas. I don't think I know the difference between a viola and a violin.
You know, because this song is really all about, it's like a big violin. This song is like really all about nostalgia. Are you nostalgic for like this era of YouTube? Because you know this video would be so annoying now. Whereas like this is just like charming and like it's
so nice. True.
You never get a nice video and no one ever makes nice videos.
Also,
it's always
a YouTube short and it like breaks your browser.
Yeah,
this one's so nice. Yeah, and it kind of looks bad and it's like cropped weird.
Yeah.
It's true.
Yeah, like the cropping is like, I think, sort of uneven between each of the...
Yeah, because sometimes there's some sort of weird pink... What even is that? A toy? A case of some kind?
It's a viola case.
That's really nice. Well, I think you're going to like this one too. This is by Frank Bass Cover, which is... perfect last name for him because he is frankly doing a bass cover of the song with no backing tracker. It's just straight up a dude playing bass. I guess you can kind of hear the backing track. Maybe I feel... just check him out. He's just chilling. Yes, bro. He's doing finger gun for the camera.
Yes.
He's got, I guess, Flea's signature bass. He's like a...
And what is that shirt that he's wearing? Like, it's...
I would assume that he's gone through a growth spurt since then, but this is... Whoa! This is a child that I think I would describe as being a little squirt, probably. Wouldn't you?
Yeah, oh yeah, absolutely.
But look, he's taking it for a walk. It's so peaceful. Yes, bro. So that's Frank Bass Cover.
This is so good. Now, Frank Bass Cover, a great guy.
Up next, this is someone called Time of Gay. And he's
what is up, you guys?
Shirtless
it is Jake here
guy,
again.
Jake.
And as we all know by now, probably, oh, I hope so, it is now Wednesday in the week. So, again, you're going to get some of me right now. Do you know?
So this is week 14 of the
I hate more
covers.
Than life itself. I don't hate life. Do you know what I don't enjoy is tan lines. I do not like.
So there's like a 3-minute preamble, but then Jake of the channel Time of Gay just.
And we're never gonna change. Say, won't
just
you stay?
Standing
forever,
in his living room shirtlessly.
If you stay forever, hey. We can
it's
stay
great. I think it's great.
This is see again. This is so good.
It's so pure.
Like you know, this would be like sinister if it was on TikTok today, and instead it's like deeply charming.
Also, because I assume there's a 3-minute explanation justifying why he's shirtless. Because of tan lines, sure, Jake.
When the sun's going down, we'll be raising our cups, singing.
It's just a practical decision.
Growing up.
Maybe he was outside, like getting. Tan before he came in to do this video. Maybe he's doing laundry. All his shirts are in the washing machine.
He's like, oh, didn't
couldn't
see
miss
you
this
there.
Video.
Oh, didn't see you there.
Say, Won't you stay forever? Stay.
It has, you know, you know who does make actually pure classic YouTube content still to this day with no self-awareness is, in a good way, is Lights, Camera, Jackson. Like his, all of his new videos.
I haven't watched them, but I believe
they have that purity to them. Okay, so that was a vocal cover. Here's one more vocal cover. This is from someone named Gecko.
Sing radio hard at the top of our lungs with the blue blocks blurring as we falling in love.
Blue blocks blurring.
This seems to be kind of a German guy, I think. Again, his baldness, his track jacket, and his small glasses.
Go hard this weekend.
He looks like a member of Delirious from King of Fools era, if that tracks for anyone. Now this seems to be from something that's like Smule but not Smule.
So, wow, oh my god, dude, this is once we run out of words for the edging episode, maybe there's something here.
So I just thought this was kind of cool energy. I don't know, are you doing okay over there?
Oh yeah, dude, I'm great.
Radiohead. There is one Smule one.
This guy's a friend of the Boss Hoss. That's sort of the vibe.
I think Little Kid Zoom is, or Little Kid Smule is kind of something we haven't checked out much, but I love it.
Oh, Smule.
There's so much.
What else can you say?
There's like 10 grand of orthodontics on display in this video.
Meet you at the spot, 10:30.
It's so sick.
We don't ever stop.
Now speaking of, this person looks like they have like a red bubble labyrinth shirt on too. Great.
Yeah.
Do you like Labyrinth? I can't tell if you're someone who's like charmed by Labyrinth or like you didn't see it when you were younger and now you like
it. I only saw it as an adult because Sarah likes it. I feel like it's really scary, to be honest, first of all. And then I feel like there's like so many horrible funk songs in it that I hate. But I don't know. It's... I think I'm neutral on Labyrinth, to be honest.
Okay. I respect your review.
I like where you're going with this, talking about classic YouTube versus contemporary, because this is a TikTok that's been uploaded to YouTube Shorts. This is someone named Gwizzle, G-W-I-Z-Z-L-E, and it's uploaded with the hashtag Gwizzle Car Jams.
Hold on. I just want to write down the phrase.
So this is Gwizzle.
Gwizzle Car Jams is like the best phrase I've heard.
but this, I think what's the problem is we just, maybe these videos are still happening, but we don't see them because they get buried by bigger ones. This does seem more verite of a YouTube, but it also, but there's also an annoying self-awareness to Gwizzle Car Jams, but it is called Gwizzle Car Jams. So maybe, I don't know, you have to decide. It does seem like Gwizzle's gonna get in a car accident. See, I don't know about that big.
Yes, Gwizzle.
Do you fuck with Gwizzle Car Jams?
I do. I mean, it's a little much, but I also think it's sincere.
Well, like she's holding her Duncan out the sunroof.
Well, yeah, she ripped open the sunroof when she hit that big note.
She was not touching the steering wheel at all. Gwizzle's going to end up killing someone, guaranteed. I mean...
And they... Oh, my God. Gwizzle, run me over with your car. I would happily die by your hand.
I mean, she's talking. She's TikToking all over YouTube as well. She has a whole bunch of vlogs with... YouTube face saying gained all these followers in a day or whatever. So that's Gwizzle Car Jams. Now, this next one, I think we're getting into a section that is just kind of very special things that I love. This is Gigi Delana. I mean, I think that I don't understand what this is at all, actually. I mean, just looking at this alone, it's so fucking crazy.
I'm very confused.
It opens with an ad that says Cebu's cheapest delivery service in short distances, Lala Move Asia 24/7 on delivery app. It seems to be an ad on a live stream, or is this a recording of a different? I don't understand what's going on, but there's like a bunch of 40-year-olds and a young girl in front singing. And she's kind of going, But doesn't it also kind of look clapping?
Two of the rivers clapping different times?
But those guys clapping, doesn't it kind of seem like they're also a projection from a different video behind the...
Yeah.
Like, it seems like there's like three layers. This is
so strange. But how are like the guys in the band the ones who don't know how to clap?
But do you think that there's three screens that we're looking at somehow? Like the bass player and guitarist are in a different area being projected, aren't they?
Yeah, they're not in the same place. They're a hologram. They're like the Tupac hologram.
What is this? The drummer's just fucking hammering away. And then he's like 50.
I mean, great though. I mean,
it's so sick. It's unbelievably good. But like, what is that? What the hell was that?
It's just art, man.
It's just she's an actress. Gigi Delana. She's a Filipino actress. Gigi Delana. Maybe she's on Famous Birthdays actually. I mean, I can tell you her birthday right now. She's born September 24th, 1995. But she's a Filipino actress, and she has an album that came out last year, self-titled. So. Maybe this is on TV in the Philippines, but then there's a TV inside the TV that has the bass player on it.
Let's see. Okay. Gigi Delana. I just need to know how popular is she, the most popular Gigi. So Gigi Delana is the 44,842nd. I'm learning that I really struggle to read a number. 842nd most popular person on Famous Birthdays. She is the seventh most popular singer born on September 24th.
Oh, wow. That's pretty good. Congrats, Gigi.
I wonder who's the most famous singer. Alina Baraz, who's more famous than Linda McCartney. That's one of Famous Birthdays.
Now, this next one is... I was going to bring this up earlier because I think this is from Germany, maybe. This is a cover by Kevin Fleming and Friends. I really thought this was like a Between Two Ferns-style sketch with like bad post-Tim and Eric, like... what's it called? Red effects or something? Like some kind of...
Yeah.
It seems like that, but I think it's sincere. I'm very perplexed by this one. This is Kevin Fleming and Friends covering Here's to Never Growing Up. Or like those guys who did The Void, you know, they had that TV show called like Divorce Dad or something. I think it's just a German guy being sincere. I've got a bottle of whatever, but it's getting a skunk singing Here's to Never Grow. The way he sings. Then it goes to this. Friends, go
hide this. What is this? For no damn
reason, I don't think we'll ever change. Why are they all coming? It's kind of shot like the opening credits of like a sitcom. All these Germans in the forest with fake VHS effects on top of them. They all sing so crazy. It says 339 views. Each person in the video, their Instagram is linked from here.
But the thing is, like, outside of the weird VHS effect, everyone is basically doing the same acting to camera as in the, like, first selection of videos that you show.
I know. And also, why does every German person sing with, like, a faux Kermit voice? Like, oh, the battle of a devil. This is so weird.
Like, this looks like Too Many Cooks.
Yeah.
But with a bunch of, like, vines, like, older Vine stars kind of energy.
But again, like, you know, there's like, the VHS effect that's obviously fake. But still, a video of this level of sincerity with, like, they're hosting a kids show and dancing and singing. What year do you think this is from, this video?
This is from 2019. There's something just so wrong about it.
It's 2022, actually, is when this is from.
No.
Singing radio. That guy's so fucked. He actually is like dressed slightly hip too. Like if he was in like a hyped hardcore band, it would make sense. But then he's like doing like musical theater dancing in the Black Forest, and being like,
is there like a punchline at the end? Is there like a punchline that we're missing? Like, are they all gonna?
No, look, like the video they uploaded after this was a cover of Breakfast at Tiffany's. Like,
oh, what a tune.
There's a little blooper, I guess, but
that was... Wow, they're all just...
What a strange...
Nice friends, eh?
Now, this next one, I couldn't tell if it was a cover of it or not. This is called Here's to Never Growing Up. It's also from last year, but it's uploaded by Bardesha Okamoto on an album called Flavor Timber. It sounds like it could be, though. Like, singing Radiohead at the top of our lungs with a boombox playing... I don't know. I can't tell. Do you think it is?
I don't think it is.
I think I did. I do think that I found like some new deep corners of the web, which makes me happy.
Yeah. No, I'm happy for you for that.
That one's definitely not a cover, but this one by AA826 sure as fuck is. This is the best cover. Like a little boy in a tie-dye shirt in his grandma's living room.
Once again, like a different era of editing videos. Like
playing, cooking on the piano, barely staying alive on the drums, horning it up, some capo guitar in mom's bedroom. I love this kid, AA826.
This is so good. The aesthetic, okay, once again, we've talked about this. We do share the notes in the Discord. It's like another tremendous perk,
yeah, so of many the Patreon. Perks of, once you've made it 3 hours in, you should, yeah.
Yeah.
Oh, it's sad that the comments are turned off on this. I hope no one was bullying him because he's so tight. Like that. Oh.
Yeah, this is sick.
I hope you were nice to him, everyone out there in internet land.
I can see what this is in your cool delight section or whatever.
Yeah. Okay. Well, I am gonna wrap it up here because we got a lot to get to still. There's also the the part of the episode that's important coming up. So, This one I had to play though. There was a bunch of remixes, but this one I had to play because this is the workout remix. 155 BPM. I mean, come on.
Just like that, all our friends go hard this weekend.
Yes.
For no damn reason, I don't think we'll ever change. Meet you at the
155, baby. It's the perfect BPM. Often when I'm designing episode art, too, I often... find that 155 is the perfect font size for our art.
Of course,
it's the perfect number. Is this a different vocalist or just a weird edit?
No, I think it's just like a weird edit and sped up. Maybe it is a different vocal.
Oh, I can't wait for the Radiohead drop. Oh. There we go.
I'm fist pumping.
Okay, I got two left for us. Now, we learned all about the ins and outs of the Bat family earlier in the fan edit section about 2 years ago when we talked about that. And the reason I included that is because there's a character that we're all going to learn to love from the account JDean Animation. This character is called Bat Bear, and it's a very shitty CGI bear in a Batman suit. that's singing Avril Lavigne's Tears and Never Growing Up. So check out Bat Bear. Everyone, coming to a theater near that's Bat Bear. Kind of cool. Do you like Bat Bear?
I do. I'm compelled by Bat Bear.
The audio must be horrifying for those not getting the visual. Again, this show is mostly just for Sam and I. And it shows the ad. Jadeen Music. Jadeen Music is the tag, and it says account suspended. The account violated the Twitter rules. So.
Yeah, not shocked. So this is like a kind of CGI kind of cub, like a cute little baby bear, but like in a full Batman costume,
like 60s Batman, I think.
Yeah,
this also has
dancing like a Teletubby, I would say.
This only has 37 views. Bat Bear also sang "Nothing Like Us" by Justin Bieber and "When I Was Your Man" by Bruno Mars. It's those three videos on this channel.
This is fucked, dude.
So I mean, I found some new stuff, right? I think so. I think this. Has been...
I'm so happy for you.
Well, let's do our
Let's
do our final thoughts over top of "Here's to Never Growing Up" by Mini Pop Kids, which I think is K-Tel's version of Kids Bop.
Okay.
So I mean. I think what better way to introduce the concept of saving the green belt than this episode, Houston Never Growing Up. You'll hear all about, if you haven't figured it out yet, you'll hear all about our guest. She'll explain who she is and why she's here and why we're going to be talking about what we're talking about this month. I mean, Avril Lavigne is pure pod, right? Like, that's all we want is to talk about Avril Lavigne. That's,
well,
whenever we're wanting
to talk about the Hold Steady or Japan.
I mean, that's...
I mean, those are...
I agree. Like, the whole... your month is kind of like dry January, where it's like a nice moment of introspection, but Pure Pod is like... This is it right here.
This is it.
It's
this
mini,
is the stuff.
Mini Pop
this is
Kids.
Stuff.
K-Tel yes. Presents.
I'm so excited for this month. I really am.
I hope that the...
Listen to it.
I hope the potential guest doesn't listen to this episode.
Oh, yeah. That would be a mistake.
The first week of, I forget what we call this month. April Lavigne is the name of the month on our show. We're going to be talking about Avril Lavigne all month. And this is a very special guest to have on the first of April Lavigne. I want to welcome to the show my new friend, Ever. Ever, why don't you go ahead and explain, just for those who might not know, you know, who you are, why you're on an Avril Lavigne podcast in 2023.
Well, I am an environmental activist, and I was recently referred to very commonly as the Junos streaker.
Right. And so, recently at the Junos, you went on stage and you in protest. I mean, you know, that's even that has become a source of discourse. Are you a streaker? Are you a protester? Are you a bit of both? You know, these are the kinds of things that people you've started a huge conversation with what you did at the Junos a few weeks ago. So I'm so thankful that you're here. I guess. The first thing I want to ask you, and you live in Vancouver, which is where I'm from, and you know, there's all kinds of things in the media about you. I know that we're actually the same age as well. So we're Vancouver, we're the same age. Maybe we'll find some common ground here today. But my first question for you is, why the Junos? What, I mean, I saw you say in a news article that the Junos are this international event. Now, I'm kind of a hater. And I'm a former music writer in Canada. I think the Junos, I think that what you did is probably the best thing that's happened at the Junos ever, maybe.
That's not the first time I've heard that either. The Junos was proposed to me just because it is a live international broadcast. And it was actually me that chose Avril and that chose to go topless. I chose Avril because she's been all over, social media lately, her love life and whatnot. And I just knew that it would make a big headline and a lot more people would pay attention. And at the time we were under the impression that she would be performing. So the idea was to do it while she was performing. But then she wasn't performing and we were like, okay, I guess we got to hang out at the Junos all night and wait for Nickelback to go up there and ruin their minute. And then as soon as the Avril came up to announce a performance, it was just like, okay, this is it. This is the moment that we wanted. Let's do this right now. And yeah, that's why we chose the Junos. What we did that day, we call a mobilization action. It's to get people's attention. And like you said, we did. We got people's attention and we got their attention on multiple different fronts. Too. I've been asked about feminist issues. I've been asked about prison reform, and all of these are so important and things that I feel very passionately about. But we're here to talk about On to Ottawa, and that's why we took the Junos. We took all the attention away from the Juno.
Right. I mean, yeah, you mentioned Nickelback. I'm pretty sure they received a Lifetime Achievement Award.
We were just laughing so hard about that. I was like, okay, well, if Apple's not playing, then let's like ruin their Lifetime Achievement Award, because nobody will take that seriously, and that would be hilarious to people.
So I love that, you know, you've mentioned a lot of important issues. Now I want to real quickly talk to you about Avril Lavigne's love life, because you mentioned that. Are you like on social media? I found it, maybe it's because your name's Avril. I found it very hard to track you down for this. But are you on social media? Like, are you actually, were you like, oh my God, if Avril Lavigne dumped Maudsun through her publicist and is now dating Tyga, this is the perfect...
I had never heard of Maudsun before, but we've all heard of Tyga and what a sleazy loser he is. So I think the whole world heard that and was like, no, not our Canadian punk princess.
Right. Yeah, well, Maudsun, you know, this is... I feel like I shouldn't go into a long explanation of Maudsun to you, but she did.
They're both on Travis Barker's label.
Exactly. Yeah. See, you know what's up. You're ahead.
Travis Barker is married to a Kardashian who, basically all these steps of separation, they're all connected.
Exactly. Yeah, you know what's up. And Maudsun. Maudsun was engaged to Avril, and he wrote a whole album basically about her, and then he left on tour and she dumped him through her publicist the first day of the tour. So it's kind of a very, very hard time for I know. But so, like, I think what's really interesting that I keep thinking about is there's this quote from you, and I couldn't find an audio clip of it. I'm not going to make you recite it again, but you said, I low-key in my heart of hearts hoped that she would be like punk rock, girl power, give me the mic or something. And there's this other – I saw this other thing on Twitter. Somebody said, sadly, Avril Lavigne has aligned herself with Capitol. Now, I think the core tension of our show is trying to understand – what punk means at this point. And I mean, did you really think that Avril Lavigne was punk enough to be like down for the cause, or were you kind of like, let's be honest here. Did you really think she was going to be like, yeah, punk rock, anarchy, like crass kind of vibes?
Honestly, I don't think any of us really believed that from the start of her career. And nor would I think that she is actually, you know, anti-capitalist or, you know, supportive of women during, I don't know, what is it, International Women's Month? I don't know. But, you know, like I said in that quote, in my heart of hearts, I really wanted to believe that she was the person that she has projected and that she would stand up beside somebody who, you know, I understand that in that moment, like, you just react, right? Mm-hmm. But, you know, I totally hoped that it could have went differently, but I could not be happier for the way it went. her reaction is like, she's part of a huge part of like people's interest in this right now.
Right. Yeah. Cause she, I mean, she really did. She kind of went in like reality star mode. She was like, she said like, the Canadian's going to come out of me, bitch, or something. It was like, so,
oh my God. I laughed so hard. And I'm like, honey, that's so cute. Like, at no point was I going into this being like, I want to meet Avril Lavigne or I want to fight Avril Lavigne.
Okay, so yeah, where are you actually from? It says everyone said you. It
seems I grew up in Ottawa, so like I grew up going to like basement dungeon shows. I don't know if you're familiar with that. You mentioned that we're about the same age.
Yeah,
but I grew up out west here. So like we had this venue in Oshawa called the Dungeon, and it was like an all ages venue where like big names would come through. Like, at the time a big one for us was like, you know, Kitty would come through,
right?
Or like Hatebreed or like stuff like that. Sum 41 played at the Dungeon a bunch before they got famous. Gob, you know.
Oh, Gob, friends of the show. You know, this happened, I think, wait, did this happen in February? Or no, this was March. It was March, right? Yeah, okay, well, this happened at the tail end. We had just done Gobuary on the show. We had Tom on the show every week doing the show. So big Gob fans over here. So you kind of, like, you grew up around, you know what's up. So when, I mean, I don't want to. To be honest with you, I do want to make this a lot about Avril Lavigne. But when Avril Lavigne first came out, you must have, like, were you a fan ever?
I'm the same age as her, right? So I was in grade 9 when she came out with Skater Boy.
And like, were you into it? Were you down with Avril?
No. I was not a fan. I was more I was discovering classic rock at that time, like Black Sabbath and Pink Floyd. Alan Parsons Project, big fan. And I was also like really into like Nine Inch Nails, and I was, I hate saying it, but I was a huge Marilyn Manson fan, and we're all just really devastated that we can't enjoy that anymore.
Right. But yeah. That's rough. But okay. So you, I mean, how
long? It wasn't my thing. Punk music's never been my thing. I always, like, I grew up going to punk shows.
Right.
It's like, that's where the party was, right?
Uh-huh.
I was more into like heavy metal or industrial or like classic stoner stuff.
Okay. Yeah, that tracks. But like, it's funny to me. So when you heard Skater Boy, you probably didn't realize that one day you were going to face off against Avril.
I don't know. Maybe it's been destined, written in the superstars.
So, is there any Avril Lavigne songs that you kind of low key fuck with, or no?
I think I only like know like the Skater Boy, the Complicated.
Mm-hmm.
I don't know anything. I only realized that she had just released a new album in the last few weeks of doing my research for this little project. it's just not my type of music.
Yeah, fair enough. Okay, well, that's fair enough. I guess to swing back to some things you were saying earlier, like you mentioned it could not have gone any better. From your perspective, there has been like, it feels like a lot of people have had a lot of things to say about it in terms of, you know, like, but like also just there's been these debates and there's been people weighing in from every side of the spectrum, and I'm just curious, like, is there anything about it that you wish you would have done differently, or like, even in terms of like what you wrote on yourself, like, do you wish that I don't know how you could write something concise and clear on your body that would be shown in 3 seconds and make sense, but I mean, I'm just curious if there's anything you would have done differently.
I'm pretty proud of the action as is. No, I don't think there's anything I would have done differently. I have been thinking lately of like, somebody said I should have had a sign. I'm like, oh God, I didn't even think of it. But, if I had a sign that kind of said, demand climate action now would have been the only thing I would change. Everything that I had written on my body, only two of the images really showed clearly what I had written on me. So what people saw immediately was either for the Greenbelt or for Land Back. And I want to take this moment to 100% agree with the Indigenous community is that I have no right to speak for them, nor do I assume that I can. The reason I truly believe in Land Back and in saving the Greenbelt and in stopping old growth logging and stopping the TMX pipeline is because these are all the very first steps that our government need to take climate action seriously. The numbers that were written on my chest reference a countdown that today is officially the 2-year mark of the countdown. We have 2 years to make these changes globally. And our government, our Canadian government, has slated these changes for the next 5 to 10 years. So, like, we don't have that much time. We have 2 years to make these changes and curb these O2 emissions and to transition. And I think that's the really scary part for people is when we talk about our dependency on fossil fuels and on, you know, we do need to cut down trees for certain purposes, but there's no reason to cut down 1,000-year-old trees other than for profit and greed. These 1,000-year-old ancient forests are one of our most important carbon sinks that we have here in Canada. And while we transition away from fossil fuels, we need those carbon sinks. There's no way that logical people who are part of this movement think that people are just going to stop driving and stop using cell phones and stop, you know, needing timber. You know, we're not actually idiots. We understand that these things take time and it takes time to transition, but what we're saying is that we need that transition to start now. And that's why we're going there. We're going to try and get as many people on board with us as possible along the way, doing actions and demonstrations along the way. And it's time that we all stood up and demanded our democracy, because at this point we all know that we don't have true democracy here in so-called Canada.
Wow. Thank you so much for clarifying all of that and putting it that way. Now, well, I mean, I have so much to say. I'm so excited that you're here, by the way. Thank you so much for doing this. But, you know.
Thank you so much. I did this action at the Junos for stuff like this, for doing this press. I'm so excited to have all of these perspectives and talk to so many people. I really do appreciate it. That's why we're doing this.
And that's the thing I think a lot of people misunderstand is they say, oh, the Junos streaker. But really what you are doing is that's not the entire conversation. You're just starting a conversation when you do something like
exactly.
that.
Exactly. And if I can point out something about the Junos streaker thing, when I was put into police custody, and I was in the squad car. You know how they have that screen there and you can read everything. And it said female in custody for exposing herself at the Junos. And I asked them, I was like, so if I was a dude and I did not have my areolas covered, would I still be exposing myself?
Right.
And they had a little laugh about it and like said some like, police BS at me. And yeah, I feel like that has a lot to do with where all like where the rage comes in, because when a woman stands up and uses her body for something that she believes in, it scares people because they're not commodifying it.
Right. That's an interesting, I mean, even like theoretically, that could be, I feel like what you were wearing could almost be someone's stage clothes at an awards show too. It's not even that far off.
Funny. People are saying, like, if I'm a streaker, I'm naked. I was very clearly not naked.
Right. Yeah, that's interesting.
And like I wasn't exposing myself. I had pasties on.
So one question I have is like, what does it look like to prepare? I mean, did you just like sort of logistically, did you write all this stuff on yourself? Did you have a friend writing on you? And are you like, oh shit, what if I sweat too much? It's going to accidentally say and ack when I get out there or something.
No joke. I am such a sweaty human. And I was so worried about smudging things on the way in. I was like, I can't actually wear a coat because if I put my coat on and going into the venue, I'm going to sweat all these words off.
So good. Also, did you have to buy a ticket to the Junos, or is there an insider?
I mean, not personally. I didn't put my money up, but yes, tickets were purchased. I was approached by a member of Onto Ottawa asking if I would be interested in dramatic action. And they asked me specifically because they know I love dramatic action. I was their dramatic action person for the FIFA action that we did in Vancouver.
Okay.
Another person and myself representing Save Old Growth. We disrupted a FIFA game. And were arrested. We were not held for the night, luckily, and charges were dropped. But we did make international headlines. Not as big as we did last week, but still.
Wow. So speaking of charges, so you had to hang out with some Edmonton piggies, and then did you say you spent a night in jail or something?
Dude, I did not pass go. They did not take me to the police station. They took me straight to Canada's largest industrial prison complex.
Oh my God.
And I spent the night in prison, yo. It's fucked. It's so fucked.
Holy shit. That's crazy.
Yeah. It's so crazy. I didn't get duty counsel for at least 16 hours.
That is insane.
Because the action was taking place at night, we had, we have to be prepared in everything. So, like, I didn't think I would be arrested, but we were prepared for arrest. So mm-hmm. I had an arrest support team, which was also one of the people who drew on me before the action and helped me get to Edmonton as well.
What happens now? Like, do you have to go back to Edmonton and appear in court, or do you have to pay fines, or what? Or was the night in prison enough?
Did you know that in Alberta, legal aid is only a loan? You have to pay it back. I just found that out.
Oh, no.
Yeah, so I don't actually have to go there and represent myself. I will have a lawyer to do so, but unfortunately, I'll have to pay back the thousands of dollars that it costs to have a lawyer in Alberta.
Oh, my God. So are you going to, like, will there be, like, crowdfunding or something for that?
I'm really hoping that when all of this, because, like, this is the infancy of Onto Ottawa. Mm-hmm. This is the first caravan leaving on Saturday. There'll be another one in August and so on and so forth until we get our citizens assembly.
Right. Okay. So let's talk about that real quick. And the other thing is, we have an international listeners. So maybe if there's anything that they can do as well outside of just Canadians, that would be helpful to know. But because I know there's a few groups called Onto Ottawa, it seems. And I saw your name associated with this one. So I'm just curious if you could explain your specific Onto Ottawa and what is a citizens assembly.
So a citizens assembly is as close as we can get to demanding our democracy, basically. So what a citizens assembly does is it randomly selects people from all age groups, wealth, incomes, race, religion, etc. And then these people are presented with yes or no questions. Would you like to see climate action happening now? You know, so that's what a citizens assembly is. And I kind of like explain it to people this way. I used to live in Ireland, and right before I moved there, they had a referendum for marriage equality, and every citizen for their referendum is asked a yes or no question: do you support marriage equality? And the country came out like way in support, like very, very supportive. And then while I was living there, they did another one to repeal the Eighth Amendment to make it legal for women to have abortions, because up until that point, you could be arrested coming back from an abortion when you land on Irish land. They could arrest you for having gone to the UK and had an abortion. So when they did that referendum, the whole country, again, got asked, do you want to see the Eighth Amendment repealed? And again, the country was almost unanimous in that, yeah, we got to get rid of this. So right. That is like the most beautiful form of democracy. Hi, we have an issue. Okay, we're going to ask everyone what they think and what we're going to do next, and we will act accordingly. Unfortunately, the last time a citizens' assembly was called in Canada, in so-called Canada, I believe was in 1994. And the government did not follow through on the actions. So we all know that our democracy is very broken here in Canada. And for your listeners outside of Canada, I just want to say, please let people know that. Anytime I travel, people think that we live in this bubble in Canada, and that like, oh, crime doesn't happen here,
right,
and racism isn't a thing here, and like it's so far from the truth,
mm-hmm.
Just because that we're not in the same situation as the United States, we're always right behind them, you know?
Absolutely. Yeah, it's so messed up. When people do the meanwhile in Canada thing, you know, talking about America, they're like, meanwhile in Canada, everyone's at Tim Hortons or whatever. It's like not like that at all.
Yeah. It's not. And you know, when I lived in Ireland, explaining to my friends why we don't celebrate Thanksgiving, you know, and they're like, "What?" And, you know, the whole world just needs to stand up for our survival at this point, because if the countdown is accurate, which I do believe it is, that within the next 5 to 10 years, we're going to see such dramatic sea level rises that we will lose coastal communities all around the world, and it's already starting to happen. Also, like temperature changes are it's already happening. The food shortages are happening because of these temperature changes.
Right.
In Spain last month, a chain of grocery stores discontinued a bunch different kinds of fruit, and I just want to like explain how serious that is, because it's not just a store saying, oh no, we're out of plums, for example. It's a chain of grocery stores discontinuing something, saying we're not going to get that at all this year.
Right. That's insane.
Exactly. And I really feel like people don't understand that we are already living in these times where we need to stand up and we need to demand this action, because it's already serious. It's already at our front door, and it's so easy to just be complacent,
mm-hmm,
and to keep ordering off Amazon and to keep, you know, keep the status quo, but the status quo is actually killing us.
Right.
And we all need to acknowledge that.
Well, you know, Avril Lavigne's not punk enough to let you say it, but we've decided that for Avril, what did I say this month is called? April Lavigne this year. We're going to actually, all of our guest spots, we're going to try to talk to environmentalists and try to keep this conversation going that you started at the Juno. So
that's amazing.
We're going to try to do that, but I'm excited about it because we've never really talked about this on the show. It's a very stupid waste of time show usually. It's not going to be this month though. But so specifically, one thing that we're interested in talking about this month, April Lavigne on our ironic mall punk show, is learning a lot more about the Greenbelt. And I'm curious, like, specifically how your action was about the Greenbelt and if you have anything that you can tell us about it.
Well, the Greenbelt has been a protected area for decades now, and the Ford Mafia is coming for it, or as we've learned in the last few weeks, has been making shady deals already.
Mm-hmm.
And I do want to point out that in some coverage that I saw, I think it was from CTV, saying that it was a clip of Mr. Ford saying that if we don't develop the Greenbelt, where do you think all these homeless people and refugees are going to go? And I just want to say, you know, at the risk of sounding to Toronto, are you dumb? Mr. Ford, do you think that we are dumb? Because we all know that you're not developing the Greenbelt for the homeless and the refugees, because there are, 9,300 unoccupied units in downtown Toronto, and all the shelters are full through, you know, cold snaps. And, like, I know people who have chosen to sleep on the street because going to these shelters is so dangerous. So, like, it blows my mind that this man is going to say that he's developing the Greenbelt because he cares about the homeless and he cares about refugees.
That's insane. I mean, that's so fucked up. I can't believe that.
Infuriating, isn't it?
Absolutely. So we're going to be talking to people about the Greenbelt this month and learning more about that.
But
I actually don't know anything about it, so this is good for me as well. My ironic love of mall punk has led me to finally learning about environmentalism at long last.
Yeah, well, we all grew up at some point, right? But we all started out as mall punk.
Exactly. Well, Everett, it's been an absolute pleasure having you on the show. I don't know if there's anything else you want to add.
Anything I want to add. There probably is, and I'll think about it after, and I'll kick myself. I just want to say one more time that we're on to Ottawa. Our mission is to demand a citizens' assembly to address climate action now. I'm not just a streaker. I'm actually an environmental activist, and the Junos was only the beginning.
Right, and I just want to say, Avril, you're not gonna fuck a bitch up, and you keep the Canadian inside of you.
No.
We don't even believe in Canada, so get out of here.
I'm like, what does that even mean? The Canadian. Me, like, you're gonna polite me?
Yes, I don't know.
You're gonna ignore systemic issues at me?
Exactly. I think so.